for an entire generation, people have experienced Star Wars the only way it's been possible, on the TV screen. But if you've only seen it this way, you haven't seen it at all.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
We've been waiting for you.
The Force is strong here, even stronger than the coffee.
Welcome to Coffee with Kenobi. Here are your hosts, Dan Z and Corey Klug.
Hello, this is Dan Z, and welcome to show number 19 of Coffee with Kenobi, a Star Wars podcast that analyzes our favorite saga in a whole new way. With me is my good friend and co-host, Corey Klug.
Hey everybody, be sure to check out Becca Benjamin on the latest Star Wars KidCast, discussing Mothers and Star Wars. It's a great show you'll want to check out. Be on the lookout for our interview, Star Wars Rebels star Vanessa Marshall, on our new episode of Rebels Reactions. Vanessa is such a positive force in fandom, and we're honored to have a cup of coffee with her. We also want to thank our friends Thomas Riddle and Wes Dodgins from Star Wars in the Classroom for featuring us on their site, and for being instrumental in sharing our show with listeners everywhere. If you're an educator, go to StarWarsInTheClassroom.com and check out all the amazing things happening with the Rogues. This site is a must for Star Wars fans.
In today's show, we are happy to share a cup of coffee with Steve Sansweet. This Star Wars icon talks to us about Rancho Obi-Wan, as well as his thoughts on fandom and all things Star Wars. We are incredibly fortunate to be able to chat with him for our one-year anniversary. We also have some amazing reflections from our friends on this special episode that we look forward to sharing with you, as well as our own personal reflections and behind-the-scenes info. We'll also have the next offering of your Espresso Shot with the Bearded Trio with Rob Wainfur.
We'll also update you regarding Episode 7 information, discuss the spinoff films, Dennis Lawson talking Episode 7, as well as collector news. We'll introduce our topic for show number 20, and now, let's see what's brewing in the Star Wars universe this week.
Oh, wait. This is interesting.
You found something.
Our first news story for today's show is the Entertainment Weekly article. We talked about Episode 7. Of course, it gave away the information. Has a nice close photo of the cast image that has become so famous now. Entertainment Weekly is able to confirm a few extra details from pretty intense sources. And of course, we're not rumor speculation people. But if Entertainment Weekly is saying that it's confirmed and it's in the magazine and there's been no retraction, we're just going to go with it. The three things that I noticed is apparently casting began in January, but there's still a major female lead that is out there. The second big piece of news is that the initial Episode 7 script penned by Michael Arndt was significantly overhauled by Abrams and Kasdan, which of course stalled the casting process a little bit. But the other thing that I found interesting is that Hamill, Fisher, and Ford were locked in years ago before Disney ever purchased Lucasfilm. So this renaissance of Ford being pro Star Wars and Han Solo, apparently that's been in the works for a long time. I think that was the biggest piece of news to me, because I didn't know that was something that they've been locked on for years. But that's pretty cool that Lucas has been thinking about this for a long time.
I think it's very cool. I mean, it doesn't surprise me that they were locked in and kind of ready to go. I think it was a matter of just the stars aligning and George being ready. And
does it surprise you, though, that it was years before the purchase?
No, it doesn't. It really doesn't. Because I think that we've been trying to do this for a long time, and I think it's Disney was in the right position, Lucas was in the right position, and they just said, let's just do it. Let's just make the sale, and we'll move forward. We'll have Kathleen Kennedy take it over and bring everything together and just, let's just do this thing. Because I think, the actors are obviously getting older. Fans are getting older and things. They want to get it to a point where it's not too out of touch with the original three, I think. And they were just looking to move forward. So I think, like I said, the stars aligned and like they were signed on. Let's get going on this. And it doesn't surprise me that they had been signed on for years, if that. So...
See, I am, because Ford has always been so, I love Indiana Jones, but Han Solo, there's really nothing to him. That's what he used to say. And now he's, I don't know if it's, he's just gotten older and wiser, or maybe he heard the cash register making noises.
No, I think that's his shtick as far as being, the grumbly old man who doesn't really care. He cares. I honestly think that, because...
Even when all those, there was about 20 years where he just like... I don't want to have anything to do with it.
Because I think they couldn't figure it out. I think it was they're trying to get it worked out, and they never could.
I don't know. I think he just had a change of heart.
Interesting.
You're just an altruistic, happy guy.
No,
and I am too. Peter.
Sure, but I think it's even maybe they went over their mark a little bit. I mean, all the other actors did more things. But
go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I was just gonna say that I think a lot of the actors moved on to different projects and obviously said, okay, you know, we signed on, but you know, we'll just see what's gonna happen because they have no control over that. And I would think that they would let their careers to move on as well. So it's a matter of, you know, it's
not everybody gravitates towards their roles the way Hugh Jackman has with Wolverine, which is, I think, one of the reasons why he's been such a fan favorite for so long.
Oh, absolutely. He's gotten into it. It's made his career. Our second news story has to do with the rumor that was there were spinoff movies coming along with the new 7, 8, and 9. Looks that Disney chairman Bob Iger has said that expect 3 Star Wars spinoff movies. So from his mouth, they plan to demine the franchise and over the next decade to put off. They said it, originally, I think it was 2 spinoffs, and now they've bumped it to 3. Obviously, I would think that they would do something like Marvel did, where they'd center on a character and expand on their background, or do a younger version of that character and explore their how they got into where they were in the original trilogy. What do you think, Dan?
I'm excited about this, and you're right. It was originally just 2 because we were gonna have 5 new films, but I couldn't be more excited. I don't really know. No one really knows what they're going to be about. Of course, we know, again, which supposedly they are leaning towards. And I know there are some people like our friend Chad from the Cantina cast that is not necessarily crazy about these spinoff films. I couldn't be more excited because, again, it's like what Marvel's doing and their spinoff films. And there's not even any indication they could be set during the episode 7, 8, and 9 time period. Maybe it'll take place during the prequel trilogy. Maybe it'll take place during the original trilogy. Maybe it'll be something else. I really don't know. No one knows. So it's pretty exciting to think about the fact that I'm going to get 6 Star Wars movies. 6. So when this is done, quote unquote done, there's going to be 12 Star Wars movies out there. That's like James Bond situation.
Yeah, that's huge. I mean, even that they're you know, that he's saying this and confirming these releases. I mean, like you said, not that they'll be necessarily set in a certain era or not.
Right.
We don't know. It's mysterious. And I think that's the best thing about Star Wars. It's always been mysterious of what the plan is or where it's going to go. And it's always worked well for them. I think it'll be good. I think it's a good thing because it constantly bringing more fans into the fandom, bringing in the new aspects of the saga, giving us new canon, all kinds of fun stuff, and I'm looking forward to see what they're going to do and when they'll do it. So, yeah, absolutely.
So our next news story, a very interesting one, came out the other day. Dennis Lawson, portrayed Wedge, of course, in the original trilogy. They asked, apparently he was offered by J.J. Abrams to be in Episode 7, but he turned it down because Corey... he's bored by it. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I find that interesting because, I mean, if someone called me up and said, "Hey, you want to be in Star Wars?" Eating a snack on the side, I'd be like, "Let's do it." Anything that anybody, I would think, any
you
actor
would
who, would, yeah, I would do it. But I think any actor looking to reprise the role from the original trilogy and just, hey, be a walk on or be a, you know, let's have a conversation with Luke or something like that. But the old days, I mean. I think they would jump at the chance, but it's unfortunately that Dennis Lawson is not doing it. I read that today, and I was a little bummed out. I mean,
are you really?
Yeah, I think it'd be cool to have like little cameos of old actors come back and rejuvenate their roles and bring some more life to the character. I'm surprised he turned it down. I don't know the background on it, but I'd hope that maybe he changes mind and they'd have him come back, but we'll see.
I really wasn't that heartbroken. I mean, I've always thought Wedge was a cool character just because he's Wedge and he's in Star Wars. But other than that, I've never read the X-Wing books. I know I need to remedy that. But whether Wedge is in it or not, in fact, until I saw this article, never once in my mind did I think, oh, good, I'm going to see what happened to Wedge. It just, didn't occur to me, and that's not because I don't enjoy the character, but I was so worried about Han and Leia and Luke and seeing what they're going to do and where they're going to take Star Wars that I just didn't cross my mind. So this is, it would be nice to have him in. It would have been cool. And of course you want to have the same actors portraying these characters, but I don't know. It's not even a blip on my radar, to be honest.
Wow. I'm fascinated by that because, you know, when I go to see a Marvel movie and Captain America pops up in Thor, I'm like, well, that's really cool. You know, for the 2 minutes he's in there, or, you know,
well, those are, I love cameos, but like I said, Wedge has always been sort of like more of a cool part of Star Wars, but never something that was ever anything that would really hit me the way that the big three did or Darth Vader did. So I'd rather see Ahsoka show up or something like that. That Ahsoka means much more to me than Wedge does. So I'd rather see something like that or Asajj Ventress or something.
Yeah, Ahsoka would be excellent. I would love to see any characters just progress through the films and to see where they're at or have a cameo or something like that. And, but yeah, unfortunately we won't see him in this film, as far as we know so far. Well, good luck to him and all his projects, and look forward to more news. And now let's join Rob Wainfur as he pours your espresso shot with the Bearded Trio.
And now your espresso shot with the Bearded Trio.
Welcome to another Espresso Shot with the Bearded Trio with me, Rob Wainver. Coming up on today's show, we have some George Lucas news, Jurassic World news, but let's start with some Steven Spielberg news. Now, during an interview with Today, Steven Spielberg talked about the Shoah Foundation, which he founded after filming Schindler's List. Now, the foundation was set up to record testimonies in video format of survivors and other witnesses of the Holocaust and genocides. Now, so far, the Shoah Foundation has filmed interviews with 52,000 different survivors and witnesses. Now, in his interview, Spielberg said, "This is something that I was put on this earth to do, not just to make movies, but to tell this truth to people, especially young people. This could have been me if I'd been born at a different time and place." Now, sticking with the Shoah Foundation, and Vanessa Marshall, who plays Hera in the upcoming Star Wars Rebels, emailed the Bearded Trio to tell us she is a huge Steven Spielberg fan. Not only that, she dedicates a lot of her time to the Shoah Foundation. Now, in a previous event for the Foundation, Vanessa live announced Disney chairman Bob Iger, and she told us that in an upcoming event, Vanessa will be live announcing none other than President Barack Obama. Now, in fact, that event was Wednesday just gone, and you can see photos on the Bearded Trio site of Obama with Steven Spielberg. Make sure you check that out. We're actually hoping for an interview with Vanessa on our website very soon, so keep an eye out for that one. Level Film are re-releasing the clever parody short film George Lucas in Love. Now, it's due for release on May the 20th to celebrate its 15th anniversary. Now, the short movie saw its journey begin through Hollywood circles, landing on desks of assistants, making its way to executives, and eventually ending up in the hands of George Lucas himself, as well as being showed at top film festivals such as Cannes and the Los Angeles Independent Film Festival. Now, the movie will be available from iTunes and similar stores, and here's a short clip from the film.
So, Lucas, we meet again.
Aaron, you live next door.
My script is now complete. Soon, I will rule the industry, and you'll still be writing line one of whatever it's called.
3XR-259.7.
Exactly. And George, the beard, not working for you.
Now, Entertainment Weekly recently counted down the 20 best summer blockbusters of all time, and Star Wars was number 2. The number 1 spot went to Steven Spielberg's Jaws. Now, the list was chosen by Entertainment Weekly and listed based on box office takings and cultural influence during the summer of its release, and also the competition it was up against during the summer. For the record, Jurassic Park was number 3, Raiders of the Lost Ark was number 5, and E.T. was number 6. So Spielberg very well represented in the top 10. Now that grumpy T-Rex signifies Jurassic World news. So let's start with mentioning that excellent Facebook page, Real Tour Hawaii. Now they recently posted a photo of a helicopter flying over the island where Jurassic World is being filmed. And if you look closely, you can see the InGen logo on the side of the helicopter. Now it seems the organization from the original Jurassic Park and Lost World is back. In other news, actor Brian T has confirmed his involvement in Jurassic World. The actor posted a photograph showing himself beaming, and behind is his trailer with his character name. Now, the character name is Hamada. Now, this name was mentioned in a recently leaked page of the script for an open casting call. Hamada is described as a 52-year-old aging Japanese badass who was killed with bare hands. Sounds mean. Now, in a recent interview with Empire Magazine's 300th issue, director Colin Trevorrow has hinted the movie will not all be CGI. He was quoted as saying, "We're actually building more practical sets on this film than I know have been built on a film in a long time. And we're going to use animatronic dinosaurs. We're doing things that make it feel like a real world that you can touch, feel, and be part of. That was very important to me." Based on that alone, it seems to me that Jurassic World is in very good hands. I can't wait for it. Well, that's it for another Espresso Shot with the Bearded Trio. Hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to check us out on Facebook and Twitter, and also check out our main site as well. We update daily, thebeardedtrio.com. Before I go, also worth checking out a new podcast called Movie Night Carlo, where I talk Jaws in the very first episode, and in an upcoming show I will give my opinions on that classic Spielberg movie Close Encounters. Check it out, it's definitely worth listening to. That's it, thanks for listening. I'll hand you back to Coffee with Kenobi. See you soon.
Han Solo, Rebel Soldier, Lando Calrissian, and Bespin Guard, each sold separately. From Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back Collection, new from Kenner.
Looking? Found someone you have, I would say,
Your lightsabers will make a fine addition to my collection.
Well, Corey, for our first collector news segment story here in our news segment, I think it's pretty fun. This was something that I had in the show notes a couple of shows ago, but things just kept coming up, so we didn't put them in there. But our very first show, one of our collector news things that we talked about was the D-Tech experience and how you could put your face on a Stormtrooper action figure. So now it's been a year, we come full circle, and again, this was news that was out for a while, but we didn't get a chance to talk about it. This year, besides being able to still have your image, your face on as in a carbonation, you could also do the Stormtrooper thing again, but they have a new thing. You can have your face on Princess Leia or Luke Skywalker. So this is the first time it's been so gender specific. The Stormtrooper could have been either way. So you've got the X-Wing pilot, or you've got Princess Leia, and the image in our show notes, the Princess Leia figure is kind of hideous.
Yeah, the example they give, it's somebody cheesing it. I don't know who it is. But it looks like Barbara Streisand, maybe. I don't know. And then, of course, the X-wing pilot is obviously a gentleman who
it
is
looks like
looking
Mark Hamill, kind of
a little bit. But I think it's the hair. They give you they make you have the Mark Hamill 70s hair. So,
honestly, if I was able to go to Star Wars weekends, the Stormtrooper and Carmine thing, I've been salivating over those forever. But neither of these. I think look particularly appealing as far as the fact that they're just that they have the larger ones are even more expensive now too.
Yeah, I saw
either of them interesting to you?
They're cool. I'm not a huge collector of putting my face on things, but this is cool. Something unique.
You have a 16-inch one now.
Yeah.
The regular ones are $99.95, and then and plus shipping and handling. Okay, that's cool, right? But then they have the 16-inch ones, and they retail for $1,499 $1.95.
Yeah, that's quite a jump.
That's crazy. I don't know if they vacuum your house to it.
I don't know what they do. I don't know if they're flown by monkeys. Yeah, the examples they have here of the X-Wing pilot and the Stormtrooper looks like Captain Janeway from Star Trek.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah,
again, those are the... So of the four, are there any that would tempt you?
I would not do the 16-inch. That's just...
No, definitely not. No, I can't imagine anyone would do that. You save your money for the Han Solo and Carbonite. But what about... Would you do the Stormtrooper or the Han Solo and Carbonite figure? Or would you want to be an X-Wing pilot?
Stormtrooper would be cool because you got the armor and stuff. The one that does not interest me is the Carbonite because it's just like... You could make a silly face or do you smile? What do you do?
I've actually thought about that.
Have you thought about this? Lost sleep over it, have you?
Not lost sleep. And it's helped to soothe me to go to sleep.
Okay.
But yeah, I just thought, okay, do you smile? Do you look shocked? Do you look constipated? What are you supposed to do?
I don't know. I think it's up to whoever's interested in doing it and getting their face frozen in carbonite for the first time. I don't know what's the first
and
time
probably
like?
The Is last it, time.
Yeah, the first and last time. I don't know how that works, but yeah. But definitely check this out. It looks a lot of fun. I mean, obviously,
I'm hoping they have them at Celebration next year because I'm gonna line up for that.
Yeah, I bet they will. If this is a success. They will. So yeah, it looks like they expand even further into a Jedi or something. That'd be cool. Yeah.
So Corey, one of the greatest things about this year-long celebration of having coffee with Kenobi and just all the exciting things we've gotten to do with this podcast is we've made real friends. Friendships, I think, are going to last a lifetime because of Star Wars, because of the saga that we love so much. And one guy in particular that has been with us from the beginning is Aaron Harris. Aaron has been always reaching out to us, sending us emails, and we have the good fortune of having Aaron a part of the Coffee with Kenobi family now. He lives in the Florida Disney World area, and he's going to be covering Star Wars weekends for us. He's written some amazing blogs, getting ready to start the Star Wars weekend experience here for 2014. And so, Aaron Harris, welcome to Coffee with Kenobi.
Well, thank you, Dan. Thank you, Corey, for having me on. It's definitely an honor to be on the show. Definitely, it's been great having y'all as part of my Star Wars fandom over the last year. Definitely, congratulations on a year anniversary here.
Thanks so much, Aaron. And like Dan said, it's we love having people on that just be able to explore their fandom. And you contacted us about doing the Star Wars weekends, and we were like, whoa, our minds are blown. And we're like, somebody wants to go out and just represent us and have a good time, and just anything that that you can do for us would be incredible. So we really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Oh no, my pleasure. I'm just glad I'm able to help. Being so close to Orlando like I am, and of course planning on being there all five weeks, whether I was representing Coffee with Kenobi or not, I figured I would just go out, have fun, and make it a Coffee with Kenobi time as well.
Yeah, and you, it was so cool. May the 4th, you're at Disney's Hollywood Studios, and you're sporting the Coffee with Kenobi t-shirt. What kind of reactions did you get with that?
Oh man, I got a lot of looks, a lot of cool t-shirt, man. I even had one Disney employee stop me when I was standing in line trying to get a Coke and started talking to me about it. Matter of fact, I'm going to see him probably Saturday and meet up with him then. So, yeah, a lot of people were liking the shirt. Got a couple people I directed them to the site through iTunes, trying to get them to listen. Anything I could do to promote the podcast, because you guys do such a great job promoting fandom.
Oh, thank you. Well, you're doing a great job promoting us, and just your passion for Star Wars is contagious for Corey and myself. So you were a big part of Star Wars weekends. And how many years have you been going to Star Wars weekends? And what is it that you love so much about it?
Well, this will actually be my third year attending Star Wars weekends. And basically what I love about it is just how contagious the atmosphere is. You can't go near Hollywood Studios without picking up that something big is going on. And once you cross through those gates and you see all the Star Wars posters and you see the Stormtroopers walking around, you see the 501st and the Rebel Legion there marching in the parades, and of course the celebrities that are all over the place. James Arnold Taylor hosting, Ashley Eckstein's there. I mean, it's just such an electric atmosphere, and there's so many Star Wars fans that just even though you don't know one from, you don't know anybody that's there unless you come with them. You all know each other because you're related through Star Wars. That's what makes it so much fun and so special.
That's well said. I mean, we talked a lot of fans, a lot of people we said have made friends through our podcast and through that. And just, it is electric, and it gets everybody excited, especially with, you know, all this new information coming out, all these new announcements. We're getting excited about everything. So what are you looking forward to? You're going every event. So what are you looking forward to the most?
Well, the one thing I'm looking forward to the most is the fact that we're having Mark Hamill here for the very first time at Star Wars Weekend.
Yes.
That is exciting. I am a little bummed he's not going to be doing autographs. I can deal with that because I'm going to get to see Mark Hamill and be within 30 feet of Mark Hamill. That's going to be just phenomenal in and of itself. So I'm really looking forward to week four for that.
Well, especially considering the fact that he's going to be in a new Star Wars film, which even for me to say that out loud and hear myself say that is just, it gives you goosebumps because it's so incredible. And you get to, it's one of his first public appearances since the major news, and you get to be a part of that.
Yeah, exactly. You just said new Star Wars movie, and I got goosebumps. So this is going to be this is going to be great because not only are we going to have Mark Hamill here, who's in the movie, we also have Peter Mayhew, who's also going to be in it. And this is just going to be just a fantastic time. And especially with Rebels coming out and all the celebrities and voice actors from Rebels who are going to be there, it's going to be great.
And your blog, your first blog for us was such a huge hit. It was picked up by the Daily Dot, and we got a lot of hits on that on our website. And you kind of talked about the fact that Star Wars Weekends and James Earl Taylor helped to rekindle your passion for Star Wars. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, that I was very surprised with how big that block went. I was very surprised and very humbled by that. But yeah, James Arnold Taylor actually had a big part in rekindling my fandom because I'd been a Star Wars fan for years and just had, through those dark times, everybody calls them, when there was between Return of the Jedi and, of course, the prequels, where there was nothing really much going on except for a book here, book there. Wasn't really much going on, so I was a little lost in my fandom and became a little stale at that point. And it had been for years. Even through the prequels, I liked the prequels, but it never was enough to get me going and light my fire again and get me all gung-ho about Star Wars. And then my buddy Robbie invited me to Star Wars Weekends 2 years ago just because he wanted somebody to go with. And I was like, well, you know what? We need a guy's day. Let's go. And met Ashley Eckstein, met James Arnold Taylor, and the really, really some of the nicest people you'll ever meet. And I mean, I was honest with them. I'm like, I have no clue who you two are, because I had never seen Clone Wars up to that point. And they were really cool about it. We talked and had a great time, had some pictures, got some autographs, and of course that was enough right there to pique my interest and go, who are these people and how are they involved in Star Wars that they don't just want to push Star Wars so much, that their love of it so much. So that's what got me into watching the Clone Wars and getting back into Star Wars. And that, from that point on, I was just explosive. And it's just been, I had not missed a week of Star Wars Weekend since. And I've been energetic, listening to podcasts, reading again, collecting. Oh man, my wife goes crazy with how much Star Wars stuff's around the house now. So.
Yes, I understand that. It's so fun, and that was a perfect segue into my next question, which is, there is a lot of merchandise that's coming out. We just had the good fortune of talking with Steve, of course, on the show, and he was talking about how excited he is about all the merchandise coming out. What are some of the things you're looking forward to when you head down to Darth Maul?
Oh man, Darth Maul is heaven on earth almost. I mean, the only thing closest to heaven is probably going to Rancho Obi-Wan because they have so much more. Mm-hmm. But definitely, they got always have some of the great best stuff there. I know, of course, me, I personally go through, I'm looking for some of the collectibles from the weekend, like the being an annual pass holder. There's some exclusive things for us that they have, certain pins, shirts, and certain little things yet. Like they'll have the Yavin 4 celebration medal that they give to Luke and Han at the end of the show. They'll have that on sale for pass holders, as well as some other things. The pins, I'm really big into collecting there. I'm also looking forward into seeing all the new stuff that Her Universe and Ashley Eckstein is rolling out, because they're rolling out a whole new line that they're premiering at Star Wars weekends. I read that online actually earlier today. So I'm looking forward to see that, because I have a six-year-old daughter who I'm trying to move from Disney princesses into Princess Leia. she's the new Disney princess. She'll be
absolutely
fine. So definitely I'm looking forward to seeing some of the new stuff, because she's got a jewelry line coming out too. So there's going to be a lot of great stuff. And some of the art that they have, because they have a whole art section in there, is just absolutely incredible. The artists that they bring in, because they'll have different artists there throughout the week, doing live paintings while they're there and selling the art that they do, is just spectacular. The whole experience is just mind-boggling for somebody who's never done it before. And even those who have been, it's mind-blowing. So there's definitely a lot of stuff to look into and to check out. But definitely I'll be getting as much as I possibly can without getting in trouble.
Well, that just gets me excited about. I mean, it's too bad I can't make it. We'd love to be there, and you're just getting me, all these things are getting me excited. I want to fly down and just enjoy it and join you guys and hang out. But how do fans and folks are going to the events? How do they get in line, and how do they get into some of these meeting celebrities and stuff like that? Is that some kind of something you guys have for an annual pass, or how'd that work?
Well, actually, the autographs and meeting the celebrities is actually open to anybody who buys a ticket to the park. You just have to get there early enough to claim your ticket. They do have a certain number of tickets they pass out for autographs. They pass them all out, and they're usually all gone before the park even opens. I know coming up this Friday of day one, I will actually be leaving my house, because my goal that day, and my friend Robbie's going with me and his brother Angelo, we're all going to go over, and our goal is to meet Ahmad Best, who was Jar Jar Binks in the prequels and the Clone Wars. And he's not a big convention guy, so this is a big deal. So we're, of course, going to be there, leaving my house at like 2:30 in the morning to get there, so we can make sure we're guaranteed a spot to meet the guy. Yeah, because this is going to be exciting. And there are going to be people I know, with Billy Dee Williams coming, Warwick Davis for sure, huge, huge draw, because he's got that multi-fandom draw that will camp out overnight. Basically all you have to do to get a ticket is get there before the gates open, get in line. They have it divided up on which celebrities are there. Week one, they'll have a line for Peter Mayhew, they'll have a line for Ahmad Best. Vanessa Marshall from Rebels is going to be there week one as well. And you just get in line and you just wait. And about 7 o'clock, they'll start passing out the tickets till they run out. And then you just report to where they are at the assigned time. There you go. You get your one-on-one time.
Now, for those folks who are Disney faithful, but they're not necessarily as familiar with Hollywood Studios as you are, where do they go to line up? Or is it obvious as soon as you pull into the parking lot?
As soon as you park and you approach the main gate, you know where you're going. You cannot miss the crowd, because it's so early before the gates even open. Security check, bag check's not even there. So they have you lining up near the bag check. So before they even start passing out, security's walking the line, checking everybody's bags, because usually as soon as they get the ticket, the rush on the main gate starts. So it's right there where you buy the tickets to get into the Hollywood studio, so you can't miss it.
And Aaron's tips are really helpful. I went to Star Wars Weekends only one time. It was probably about 5 years ago. And I think the Clone Wars was just getting ready to go into season 3. And this is how clueless I was. I was just a Padawan when it came to some of this stuff, even though I was a Disney park regular. So I'm walking around and I see all the booths lined up around the courtyard around the Sorcerer Mickey hat. And I see Ashley Eckstein and I see Dave Filoni. And I see there's a line of like probably 20 people. And I'm thinking, oh, okay, this is no big deal. So I just kind of walked up and one of the cast members stopped me and said, can I help you? And I said, yeah, I just want to meet Ashley Eckstein. They said, oh, yeah, well, you had to get tickets for that. And they went away around 7 or 6 o'clock in the morning. So there's much more to this. And Aaron, I want to ask you, you're an annual pass holder, so that means you have access to Fast Pass Plus. Or is it possible to get the tickets for Fast Pass Plus even now to line up to meet these celebrities so you can avoid some of getting there so early?
For the celebrity meet and greets, there is not as of yet. Now, trust me, I've been checking it every day because
I'm sure
Disney has Disney snuck in a little fast pass on us where you can reserve your seating for the shows that they do, which was quite shocking because by the time I found out, the Friday and Saturday shows with Mark Hamill were gone, and I was managed to sneak in a fast pass for Friday for Saturday by the skin of my teeth. But so as of right now, celebrity meet and greets are not a part of the Fast Pass Plus. The shows are like James Arnold Taylor's Obi-Wan and Beyond, the Stars of the Saga show where he's talking to the stars of the movie. Then, of course, the Behind the Force Rebel show that they're going to be doing, which is basically a voice acting show hosted by Ashley Eckstein. And they'll have any of the voice actors who are there for the week there in that show. And those of you can all get reserved for if they're not all gone already. But you can reserve those. But for celebrity meet and greets, I got a feeling it's going to be coming probably in the next year or two. But as of right now, it's not shown up yet.
Well, and I did hear on Inside the Magic that Mark Hamill's show sold out really, really quickly too. So I'm happy that you're able to secure your tickets for that.
Yes, I was up. I was up for that at 12:01. I stacked my ticket. They were all gone by, from what I understand, by 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. All the tickets were gone.
That's awesome. So
that was a late night as well.
Well, you're definitely doing the right things, and I'm excited for you. If you don't mind, when you get to meet Mark, do you have anything prepared, or you know what you're going to say or ask him?
Well, it's just a matter of what they have planned, because as of right now, the only thing I'm aware of that Mark is doing is not individual meet and greets. It's just going to be a show. He'll be a part of the show. He'll be in the parades. From what I understand, he's not actually doing an individual meet and greet where you can meet him. That's usually done during autograph sessions, which as of right now, all my sources say he's not doing. If we do, by some chance, are blessed with the opportunity to meet him, I will probably pass out.
I can understand.
I was going to say, I would probably mumble and faint. And yeah, definitely.
Exactly. So
mumble and faint. That's going to be quite mumble, a tandem.
Oh. Mumble, faint, convulse on the ground a little bit.
Yep.
So yeah.
That's one of those things. I think everyone dreams about meeting people like this, and you just hope that when you meet them, you come across as calm and laid back and not being an excitable fanboy. But it would be hard to not fall into that because Mark Hamill is a pretty big deal.
Oh, absolutely. He's one of the original three. He was Luke Skywalker. I mean, he stood there looking at the twin suns. He fought Darth Vader. It's blew up the Death Star. I mean, you can't get any bigger than that.
So I got to ask you before we let you go, there is a merchandising preview that's coming. I believe it's called Rebels Rendezvous. Is that correct?
Yes, that's coming up actually the day after tomorrow, Thursday.
And is that something you're planning on attending?
Unfortunately, that is something I cannot make it to. Unfortunately, I had already pre-committed to my daughter's field trip.
Well, that was the right choice, my friend. And not to mention the fact, and I think we can be honest, we're all friends here enjoying a cup of coffee. It's pretty expensive to get the right to buy merchandise. And I don't blame you for missing out on that.
Yeah, that was the other factor in that. To pay $200, $250 just to get in line to pay a couple thousand dollars in merchandise. Yes. I'll just fight the crowds opening day.
I don't blame you one bit. No.
Well, also, too, I think as it comes down to fandoms and fans individually, they really have to pick and choose nowadays as far as what you're going to buy, what you can afford, and what your family is budgeted out to do. And we've talked a lot about that, too. I think Aaron's got your heart in the right place. You're family first, and we appreciate that. And I think everybody who's going to this event will be able to do what they can and enjoy it as they will. And and it's awesome that you come with some tips and some listeners can get some ideas for what they can plan to do as well. And we appreciate having you on.
Oh, well, absolutely. I'm glad I was able to come on. Thanks for the invite. Just thanks for the opportunity. Being able to write the blogs for for Coffee with Kenobi, and of course being able to represent you guys during these 5 weeks is just gonna, it's just exciting, and it's a pure honor, because you guys definitely have the best podcast on the air right now when it comes to Star Wars. So this is definitely a great honor to be a part of.
Oh, well, it's truly, that's so kind of you, and we appreciate that. And we were just talking about how awesome it is to be a Star Wars fan and all the friendships that you make because of the saga that we love so much. And it's truly our honor that, I mean, you're a very talented guy, and you know so much about Star Wars, and you're a good writer and just a good person. So the fact that you would choose us to work with is something that we really appreciate, truly.
Well, y'all do such a great job. I knew it was something I wanted to try to be a part of, and definitely I'm glad I was able to be a part of it, and glad I'm able to work with you guys and represent y'all at Hollywood Studios. And I wish you both could be here, because I mean, this would just be so much fun.
Oh, I agree. It's something that Corey and I certainly have on our list of things we want to do, just as fans and as friends, and just through the podcast itself. So thank you again, Aaron. And before we let you go, you know we can't let you go without asking you our five questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, of course. So let's just jump right into it. What is your favorite Star Wars movie?
New Hope, hands down.
Okay. Your favorite Star Wars character?
Favorite Star Wars character is Han Solo. I've always liked Han Solo. He's always been that standoffish, that bold guy who never backed down from a fight, which never was me. So always looked up to that. That's what I want to be. That's what I need to come out of my shell and become.
Well, so then we have, what is your favorite line of dialogue or film moment?
Two simple words. I know.
Good one.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's it. That, to me, that whole scene, he knows he's about to get it. He doesn't know what's going on. All he knows is she's there. She finally admits she loves him. And he just plays it cool. I know.
Well said. Okay,
that was it.
Yeah.
That's my line right there.
Okay. If you collect, what's your favorite collectible that you own?
Now that's a hard one. I'm actually sitting right now in my Star Wars room, and I'm actually looking around saying, what is my favorite? There is so much. I mean, I'm very picky about what I collect. So there's a lot of just random stuff. Probably right now, the thing I look at the most is that I grew really excited to have is the fact that I had the opportunity, actually last year at Star Wars Weekends, and I met a gentleman by the name of Tim Rose. Tim Rose was a puppeteer for Jim Henson. Mm-hmm. And he actually was the puppeteer who not only was Salacious Crumb, but he was also Admiral Akbar.
That's right.
Oh, cool.
And I, of course, with my background, my parents were pastors, and I did a lot of puppeteering for the kids' ministry that they worked at, their churches and everything. And so being a puppeteer all my life as well, meeting him was just such a huge honor. And we talked literally, when I met him, we talked for about 10 minutes just about puppeteering, about Jim Henson, because Jim Henson has always been one of my heroes. And so meeting him was just such a thrill that, as a matter of fact, I believe it's still my profile picture on Twitter. But meeting him, I got an Admiral Akbar action figure that he autographed and even signed. It's a trap. So that was just a huge honor. And that by far right now is the favorite thing I have right now.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And so Star Wars, of course, means so much to so many people, but what particular messages or themes about the Star Wars saga resonate or speak to you?
Well, the one thing that always resonated with me about Star Wars and the messages is the redemption factor. I mean, you have Anakin who fell to the dark side and did such horrible things, and to be redeemed just by the love of his son. And that speaks volumes to the redemption of mankind. No matter what you've done, there is still hope for you. And that just really has always spoken to me throughout the years.
Perfect. Perfectly said. Well, Aaron, it truly is something that it's an honor. And believe me, we look forward to having you on and hearing your observations and insights into Star Wars weekends. Certainly have you check in with us whenever you can. As well as once Star Wars Weekends is over, it'll be great to kind of hear your entire experience with that. And again, we're so appreciative and grateful, and fans and listeners of our show. If you see Aaron out at Star Wars Weekends, go up and say hello. Aaron's a great guy, obviously, and Star Wars fans have become fast friends because of our shared passion for this amazing thing that George Lucas created. So, Aaron, where can everyone get in touch with you?
Well, I am all over the place. Of course, I mentioned Twitter a moment ago. I'm on Twitter at TAHarris121079. I'm on Facebook. Just search for Aaron Harris. I'm right there. And of course, those are the best place to find me. Then, of course, through the Coffee with Kenobi website, through my blogs. I'll still be blogging there through Star Wars weekend. So I'll be posting a recap every at the end of each weekend. And who knows what may pop up through the weekend itself. If something spectacular happens or some great pictures pop up, you never know what could occur during that time. So,
Aaron, thank you again for coming on such short notice to share a quick cup of coffee with us and talk about Star Wars Weekends. We look forward to seeing what you find out, and make sure you have a great time and say hello to Mickey for us.
Absolutely. I will find Jedi Mickey and tell him specifically y'all said hello.
Thanks, Aaron.
No problem. Thank you, guys. Have a great one.
So our next collector of news has to do with Ashley Eckstein and her new line of her universe products debuting, as we heard from Aaron from Star Wars Weekends. There's quite a few things going on here. Ashley always has some excellent stuff that she puts out, quality stuff, it's unique, one of a kind, and looks like they've got some jewelry, a line of jewelry coming out.
There's some cool R2-D2 stuff that she's got going on.
Yeah.
These are so popular. Our Lisa was awesome enough to put something on our website about it. But there's a video and with the full press release and shows you some of the images. This is something that, and she's going to actually be at Star Wars Weekends for the Rebels Rendezvous. At Star Wars Weekends, she's going to be returning as the host of Behind the Force Star Wars Rebels when she takes everybody behind the scenes. And a couple years ago, I saw her do that with Dave Filoni. It was extremely cool. She'll be doing stuff with trivia, and she'll be signing autographs and her universe merchandise and Darth Maul every Friday through Sunday during those events from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock. So someone, certainly a guest we want to have on the show at some point, and she's so accessible to fandom and just such a positive light in fandom. So it's pretty cool to see what this is all about.
Yeah, she definitely has her strengths in fandom, and I'm excited because she puts out these lines and they're best sellers. I think they're incredible stuff, and I'm excited to get my wife some stuff at Celebration if they've got some stuff there, and I think it'd be really cool to check all that stuff out.
Hi, this is Steve Sansweet, President and Chief Executive of Rancho Obi-Wan, and you're listening to Coffee with Kenobi with Dan Z and Corey Club. This is the podcast you're looking for.
Luke, you're going to find that many of the truths we cling to depend greatly on our own point of view.
I must be allowed to speak.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Our topic for show number 19 is not so much a topic as it is a guest. The ultimate Star Wars guest, especially if you are a collector, Steve Sansweet. Steve is president and CEO of Rancho Obi-Wan, the largest privately owned Star Wars collection on the planet. With over 300,000 unique items and Guinness World Records holder of the largest collection of Star Wars memorabilia in the galaxy. He is also the author or co-author of 18 books, 16 of them on Star Wars, a consultant for Lucasfilm, and contributor to Star Wars Insider and the official blog. When we first started the show, he was a dream guest of ours, and now that dream is a reality. This is a perfect way to share our first anniversary as a podcast with our fans. We're happy to have him join us for a cup of coffee. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you very much, Dan. Hi, Corey. How are you guys?
Doing well.
Fantastic.
I'm happy to be here, but I do have to tell you one thing. Mm-hmm. The coffee van hasn't shown up yet.
Oh, no.
Oh, it's a little upsetting.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you. Sometimes we never know what's going to happen. Sometimes Consetta will take it and go chase after squirrels, so you never know.
Okay, well, I'll forgive you this time.
Well, thank you. We appreciate that. So we'll just jump right into it with you, Steve. As you know, this is our first anniversary as a podcast, so this is certainly our capstone for the year, so we're certainly happy to have you on. And if you at any point need a refill, if that van doesn't show up, we'll just send somebody over to refill your cup for you.
Sounds great.
And I happen to know that Corey has the Rancho Obi-Wan coffee mug.
I do.
Boom. I do. That's one of our favorite items in the gift shop, actually. And one of mine personally, because I hate cups that are dark inside and I spill the coffee when I put it under the spout of the machine. This solves that because it's white inside.
Perfect.
And I will say that my wife uses it more than I do because she likes the shape of it and the feel of it. And so she's got it more than me.
Need another one, Corey.
Yeah, I do.
I need to get one myself. I need to add to this dimensions here. So the trick to interviewing Steve Sansweet is you've been asked so many questions about your collection and about Star Wars. So we had some inside help with this on these questions. So we'll just jump into it. What items have you noticed get the most attention or response when you give tours of Rancho Obi-Wan?
Well, I mean, that's funny because different people respond to different items. And so there's something that I may, you know, we'll go into some detail, but something that may just totally blow somebody's mind. And the next time I give a tour, I get a, that's sort of nice.
Huh.
So I think one of my favorite things is when I sort of talk about the Darth Vader costume I have. Some of the pieces on the costume were actually screen used in both Star Wars and Empire, and a lot of it's from an appearance costume, and it has a neon lightsaber attached. And I said, well, of course they didn't use a neon lightsaber on the screen, but
use it.
And I pull out a Luke Skywalker stunt lightsaber from probably Empire Strikes Back, although they use the same ones in Star Wars and probably Jedi. And I let people handle it. And some people, they don't even want to touch it. It's like, oh my God, I can't touch that. And other people immediately grab it and they do their best imitation of fighting with Vader. that's always fun. And then I had a group here not that long ago where people like, oh, okay. It was like, what?
Isn't that something?
So you never know. And so I'm always sort of cognizant, and the tours always change based on the reaction I keep getting all along. I mean, people love to see and hear the story about why I have a full foot cast from the stunt guy who played Weequay on the Jabba's sail skiff and was the first to go over in the Sarlacc pit. Obviously, a bit of a whoopsie, but things. I think one of the things that I invariably get a wow reaction to is a Japanese Pepsi Episode 3 Premium. And it's basically your home R2-D2 Pepsi can dispenser. It holds 8 cans of Pepsi. It makes R2's noise. And you press a lighted button and the can slides out from underneath like a real vending machine and you open the plastic lid. And as far as collectibles, people just love that. So
that is very cool.
And you know what? I've been trying to make some of our licensees, look at that and say, you know, if you could make that for a decent price point, I can guarantee you, you would sell a lot of those based on the reaction I always get. You never know what's going to get the reaction. And that's part of the fun for me, because it's not just, oh, yeah, here's a bunch of Star Wars stuff. It's a 3+ hour tour sometimes of the stories behind everything and how I acquired things and you know, can you believe this silly object and how dare they have made this and look at this strange bootleg. And that gives me the fun is interacting with all the different people who come, some of whom have a huge Star Wars collection at home and some of whom, really have never been amidst a collection of really any sort. There are a lot of non-collectors out there, and they're often relatives or friends who have been dragged along. And invariably, though, by the end of the tour, I get those people to come up and say, wow, I sort of didn't know what to expect. I thought I would be bored, but the stories are so much fun that it was a great experience. And that's what makes it for me. That's what really pays me for doing these stories.
That's wonderful. And actually, when I was looking at the Rancho Obi-Wan website, I noticed that the time for the tours kind of varied. And now you've just explained perfectly why that happens.
Yeah. I mean, when we first opened as a nonprofit in November of 2011, I thought, well, you know, both Ann Newman and I, who is the general manager without whom this place wouldn't run, we said, yeah, well, we could have tours. Let's give me Sunday off, but we can have tours Monday through Saturday, and then we can schedule them at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. After the first couple of months, it was like, oh my God, no, we can only do one a day. In fact, one of the first weeks we actually, because we had media here, we did three tours in one day. And I think I needed to stay in bed for a day or two after that. I think anybody would have. And so, you know, we fairly quickly cut that back to one tour a day, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Occasionally we'll make some changes, especially when we have events. And then the second year it was, we need to cut it down to the days when we have the most people through. And that is clearly days around or on a weekend. So it was Monday, Friday, and Saturday. And then coming into this year, we looked again, and our big object was moved more towards events. And we were just finishing up our events room, which I'm proud to say we finished up about a month ago. And so tours are now on Friday and Saturday from 2 p.m. until ? And that's worked out really well because it gives both Ann and I time to do so much else that we need to do for the museum. I mean, one of the downsides of running a nonprofit is that that is exactly what it sounds like, nonprofit. And you have to keep out there and raising money and asking for retailers or licensees and I just don't like doing that. I'm the real reluctant warrior when it comes to that. Luckily, a good friend who I met through Star Wars collecting, who was my crack addict, otherwise known as Topps Cards. Rich Smolin has become our director of development, and so he's taken on a lot of that. And of course, we have the wonderful Consetta Parker, who does our public relations and marketing. And so we have built up a really great board of directors with people who are collectors and former Lucasfilm employees and good friends and people who, you know what they're doing. And so it's very important to have that kind of community around you, just as it is to have the much, much broader Star Wars community around you.
And talking about that community and those people who come and visit the collection there, you've got to have some amazing stories that they come through. And like you spoke earlier, some of the folks are just kind of drug on through the tour, that they're just kind of rolling their eyes. And by the end, they're really like astonished and really glad they came. And can you give us some of those most moving or inspirational stories that you've had from a visit or people who have seen certain items?
Well, I'll tell you the one story that I hear a couple of times, not as much as I thought I would, that sort of makes my teeth grate and I have to sort of decide what to say. And that's, oh, I had one of those missile firing Boba Fetts. Yeah, I got it in the mail and we moved. Or, you know, the dog chewed its head off. Or, oh, yeah, my friend and I were playing in the backyard and we set it afire. That's a trick of your imagination and get into an argument, or I can sort of nod my head. But it's amazing. A lot of people talk about growing up with Star Wars and how, you know, how astonished they were, you know, to get a certain gift at Christmas because mom and dad really didn't have much money, but they saved They saved money and surprised me at the holidays. There's a wonderful YouTube video up by a guy who's become a good friend named Darren Hayes, who was the singing half of Savage Garden, the Australian group. And Darren still does a lot of recording, and he's very well known in Australia and UK, not quite as well known in the US, but he's living with his husband down in Santa Monica. And so he's been up here a bunch of times. Darren, this YouTube video, I mean, it always brings me to tears. And Consetta says the same thing. And it's about growing up really poor in Australia and mom, you know, working her hands to the bone, you know, to try to support the family. And yet every week she would put away a couple of dollars in a shoebox. And for Christmas, Darren, you know, maybe his eighth Christmas, you know, got the shock of his life when she just, you know, brought out about 20 Star Wars figures that she had saved up for a year. And stories like that, and you go, Star Wars has, I mean, it's not just collecting Star Wars. It's the stories about people whose lives have been impacted by Star Wars. And sometimes it's in conjunction with a collectible, or they'll see something like, oh my God, that was my favorite piece as a kid. And I've got a chipboard Death Star playset that was originally made in the UK by the Palatoy affiliate of Kenner. It's one of my favorite pieces. In the US, we had the plastic Death Star quadrant. In the UK, it was this amazing, much more fanciful in a way and much more simple. And it was also sold in France and Canada and Australia and New Zealand. And people see that and their eyes light up, say, oh, I wish I still had that. That's another thing I'm trying to convince some of the folks to remake. But seeing that excitement, and then there are the stories, you know, related to community, like 501st stories, you know, how the 501st got founded, how, you know, two guys in South Carolina in plastic costumes in a movie theater lobby for the Star Wars special edition sparked what has become 6,500 active members worldwide in a group that not only costumes but does community service and goes to kids' hospital wards and raises millions of dollars a year for charities like Make-A-Wish and others worldwide. And the story, I mean, one of my favorite stories, Mary Franklin, who is the lead events person at Lucasfilm and has written Bantha Tracks for many years, submitted a story to Bantha Tracks, this amazing story about two 501st guys who had never met. And one of them, his dialysis was no longer working and desperately needed a kidney to stay alive. And another member of the 501st, who had never met him, donated one of his kidneys. It happened again.
You're kidding.
Like 9 months later, the same sort of thing. And so she writes another story for Insider. And the editor writes back, Mary, why are you sending me this story again? And she had, look at the names. This is a different set of guys. I mean, to give part of yourself to someone that you know peripherally, but you share this broader sense of community with, that to me, not my collectibles, not my library, not anything I have, that to me is what Star Wars is all about. It's all about this amazing community that we have all built and that we are just thrilled to be part of and that keeps growing. I mean, we're now in third generation Star Wars, and it's people passing on the love of Star Wars to their kids. And these days the kids are as often young girls as they are young boys. And I love that fact. I mean, my estimation is that somewhere between 20 and 25% of hardcore Star Wars fans are female. And that's something that, you know, that's taken a while to recognize and taken a while. We've seen cases in recent years of girls being bullied because they brought a Star Wars lunchbox to school. And I think that's awakened a lot of people to the fact that Star Wars fans are everywhere, in every ethnic group and every walk of life, and yes, every gender. And geez, isn't that great?
Oh, it's amazing.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's the way that it should be. And of course, it's been very popular in the news recently. But this is all about passion. We all have this passion for Star Wars. I like how you talked about Topps cards as your crack, because I remember loving those things so much growing up and everything. So you've got this incredible passion. And undoubtedly, your story about that poor girl who was bullied forever in her Star Wars lunchbox, of course, she had the last laugh because of all the wonderful things that have happened to her. But how do you, or does anyone, explain your passion to a non-Star Wars fan?
Well, there are a couple of different ways. I mean, number one, I clearly had inherited the collecting gene from someone in my family, because I've been a collector all my life, whether it was soda cap lids or baseball cards or the wrappers you used to get off the loaf of white bread. And I just love collecting things. My dad was a liquor salesman, so he would bring back sample swizzle sticks, matchbook covers. I had a huge collection of matchbook covers. But I always loved science fiction. I grew up reading some of the classic science fiction and grew up with the space program and was fascinated by both the fictional and non-fictional side, and had some space toys as a kid. So really my collecting then, of course, you know, back then, you know, once you were 12 or 13, that was the end of toys. I mean, because, you know, that was kid stuff. And that was before video games, too. So, you know, you had to grow up. We're going to get you any toys. That's ridiculous. And so coming back at it in my 20s and seeing some of these, going to toy shows and seeing some of these incredible space forts and old Japanese robots, battery operated and wind up. And I started collecting that. And then Star Wars came out and blew me away. And then I started buying stuff off the shelves, new, from Star Wars as part of, you know, my space toy collection. And then Empire Strikes Back closed the deal for me. And Star Wars became more and more important, to the point when I moved up to Northern California to work for Lucasfilm. That was the beginning of the end of the space toy collection. And, you know, over the years, that's sort of been sold off on eBay. And it's helped to pay for Rancho Obi-Wan and also collecting Star Wars toys, which there are still people out there who think that every licensee sends me every Star Wars collectible. And I got to tell you, it ain't true. Shopping with everybody else.
Well, I like the idea of an early toy run in the morning and running to Walmart or somewhere and then running into you in the toy aisle. I think that's pretty exciting. I bet there are a lot of good stories of just that.
Oh, yeah. People, when the figures were starting to come out again and the internet was taking off at the same time, and I would get these people posting or putting, I can't even remember how, but probably on some forum or something, I saw Steve Sansweet in the Kenner toy aisle, you know, because they bought the Kenner toys after Hasbro got them, you know. Yeah, he bought a blah, blah, blah. And I thought, geez, I better watch what I buy in public.
Well, you may, it's like, it's that, I think Consetta had told us that you at one time had the largest collection of E.T. memorabilia, too. Is that true?
Unfortunately, I think I still do, because nobody wants to buy it.
As evidenced by those cartridges.
Well, I know. And we just put up on, we have an eBay store called Toyrifics that sells non-Star Wars stuff. We also have our Rancho Obi-Wan dupes deals, which just shows you how ridiculous I was in buying, because I would forget and buy more than one of something. So we're selling off all my dupes to benefit Rancho Obi-Wan. But we've just put up two of the store displays for those E.T. cassettes. And it's sort of funny that this whole story is so bizarre about, you know, the actually digging up and finding those cartridges, which, oh my God, I remember it was such an awful game. It was akin, it was the video game version of the Star Wars Holiday Special. It was, you couldn't even get past the first level, no matter how easy it was. It was just boring. So, yeah.
All I knew how to do was push the button and raise his neck.
Yeah, right. It was just insane. And so, yeah, we've sold off a bunch of the ET stuff, actually, but I've got a lot of the store displays still left. And that was a hard sell because I say not only did I have the largest ET collection in the world, I think I had just about the only ET. But you take that character out of the movie and he is gosh darn ugly. Like, what are you collecting? I mean, it was great fun. But I had this wonderful collection of battery-operated robots, and I have still kept the first one I bought for like $9.79 in the Hollywood toy shop. Nothing special, plastic, but it was the first. Just something called Robbie Robot, along with a thousand others called Robbie or Robert Robot. And yeah, he's still on my shelf here.
That's great. Now, as far as like you talked about E.T. and some other things, and as far as your non-Star Wars passions, do you have any others besides that? Or you know, are you all trying to finish up collections that are non-Star Wars? What are some of those?
I do not. I mean,
okay.
Collecting right now is strictly Star Wars. There's, you know, even in a slow year like this one has been, Star Wars Weekend starts up this weekend. You know how many special items they have?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it's all cool. And I have like this huge collection from Star Wars Weekends going back to the very beginning. And so even in the years where I can't make it down to Orlando, I try to have somebody shop for me and try to keep that. There are certain collections I want to keep complete. And you know, I'm still sort of trying to figure out going forward with at least 5 new movies and Disney saying, yeah, one of the ways, you know, what we paid for were the rights to make the movies and to merchandise them much more than they have been.
Wow. And
the first time I heard that, I thought, guys, you weren't around for episode 1. Just be a little careful about it.
Yeah,
true.
All right, and then I see the merchandise, you know, I hear the Disney stores are going to have exclusive merchandise, and I go, oh, no. And then I see the merchandise, and my eyes light up because it's amazing. I mean, they got it, and it's like, okay, you got me again. Gee, oh, give me a break. Put out some crap. There have been some pieces in the past which have been pretty bad, but
less than stellar.
But even those are fun because nobody else bought them. And so I show people something. I mean, they did 2 like Erector sets, Star Wars ships Erector sets that are awful, but so awful that they're fun to look at. I mean, it's just like, what were you thinking, guys? I mean, gee, Willie.
Well, I still have the Taco Bell Episode 1 cup toppers, and those are kind of hideous, but sort of enjoyable too.
Well, you know, the food items have always been very important to me. The stuff, the consumables, the wrappers, the things that everybody else throws away, because to me that shows how much Star Wars became and has stayed part of popular culture. When you have fast food items or yogurt or Laughing Cow cheese or, you know, any of 100 other things, you know, I will tell you, I rarely tell anybody this, but on the top of my want list is a 1977-78 box from a TV dinner in the Midwest that had a Star Wars promotion on it. And I have searched high to low for this. My friend Duncan Jenkins has one, and then one appeared on eBay out of nowhere. I've had this search for years, and I should have realized better that my other major friend and also a member of the board of directors, Gus Lopez, would in a ridiculous topping bid, because that was an item that he had long wanted to. So even though I put in a very high bid, and I guess I made him pay more, he was not too upset. I'll still search for it. So any of your listeners
who have the 1977-78 box for the Star Wars TV dinner, let me know.
We will certainly send them your way.
Absolutely.
I still have a, I have, this isn't the same, but I still have the Pizza Hut box from episode one.
Well, of
I
course.
Have a couple of them, actually. Oh, yeah. And I remember my mom kind of smiling and thinking, Dan, you're crazy, but you know what? At least you're not doing drugs.
Yes. There aren't any Star Wars drugs, but people have done Star Wars blotters of the kind that in the 60s they were putting LSD on.
Oh, my.
I've seen those on eBay, and you know, Star Wars. Yeah, I think they're called Star Wars blotter. They obviously do not come with drugs.
No. Yeah. Well,
I hope not.
That whole thing that we just had Jeff McGee on from Assembly of Geeks and Marvin Dog Media, and he was talking about the fact that collectors, it's sort of like an addiction, but it's a healthy addiction as long as you're wise with your budgeting. And of course, we're huge collectors as well. So there's just something about that hunt, that passion. You almost become like Indiana Jones, going for that exciting item that's out there too.
Oh, absolutely. The fun is in the hunt. And although there is a satisfaction, you know, to get something that you've been looking for a long time. I finally completed my collection of Empire Strikes Back Hershey Candy pack card backs. And these were like trays of seven different Hershey candy bars. And I had everything except like, oh, I don't know, some nut bar or some weird thing like that. And I finally got it. And of course, now I can't find the other ones to put it with. and so, but I know that collection is complete. And that just feels really good to a collector to complete that stuff. And then again, there are people who do so much stuff, like I told you about my Topps addiction, who make it impossible to be a completist and have succeeded in getting me off being a completist when it comes to top sets, because you know now there are so many ones of one, and you know, one per 5,000 packs, and you know, guys, yeah, I don't really know that helps the hobby, but and Tops is not the only one. I just use them as a sample, but they have broke me of my need to be a completist in many, many areas. I still want to collect all the action figures. And I still want to get the base sets of the Topps cards because I love them. But, you know, I can remember one licensee that I actually wrote for. There were these metal cards, if you remember, back in the 90s.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I did most of the writing for the backs of those. And I still remember the bottom of the tin. Limited edition, $49,999. You know, it's like the plates, which haven't been done for a while. Limited number of firing days, only 265. Of course, each firing day they can make 10,000 plates. So, you know, a real limited edition. On the other hand, if it's really limited, or if it's a sealed box or a black bag or something like that, it gets me a little frustrated. And then I have to remember, well, hello, the early Topps packs were basically that. I mean, you didn't know what cards you were getting in there. You just kept buying them until you were able to do a full set. So it's, you know, it's the hit and miss kind of thing, and you know, finding the right tin and sort of you know, just swallowing a bit and say, you know, it's silly to buy to get a set of 24 of these things, whatever they are, and I'd have to buy maybe 100 boxes, and who knows if even then there would be something that I'd still be missing. And so maybe I'll buy it on eBay, even if it's a high price, because I know I'll be getting them all.
Well, and I, when you're saying this, I can't help thinking about one of my many Star Wars addictions is the vinyl mations and trying to find those, you know, those special, what I can't even think of the name now, the mystery box.
There's, if you buy a shelf box, you'll get one of the Chase figures.
Right. The Chase. Yes. Yes. It's the ghost of Obi-Wan one that I can't seem to get.
Yes, well, and the only way I got it was eBay. I bought, you know, because you get, I buy a box, and so mm-hmm. I get the full set and the regular Chase figure. But the only way to get that, you know, without spending a ridiculous amount of money for all those, and you still won't know if you got it. Because I don't know, right. You know, how is it every five boxes that one of those is packed in? Or
that is correct.
And so, you know, that's when you have to, yeah, I love those too. And
they're great.
Vinylmation are super. And they have a bunch of them now that are just starting to appear this weekend at Star Wars Weekend. So it's the totally new set with the chase and the ultra rare chase. Then there's a Rancor.
And the Rancor Keeper.
The Rancor Keeper. And then there's the 3-inch Luke with the mini Yoda for his back. Oh. In there. I love those things. Yeah.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that about the Yoda.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, go online. I'm sure you'll find them pretty soon.
They'll be all over. Well, I'm even excited about, and we're going to go in early July, so I'm going to miss Star Wars Weekend, but we have people covering that for us, fortunately. But I'm even excited about the Indiana Jones Vinylmations.
Yeah, I think they're going to be very cool. I mean, out yet?
They are. I know because I heard the guys in the IndieCast reviewing it.
Oh, cool.
Because I think the chaser on that is Indy in his Cairo map room gear.
Well, just as long as you don't say it's India's Han Solo, because they did that for something, and I can't remember offhand what it was, but it was.
It's crazy.
maybe it was one of the Kubrick series, was an indie. It was all Star Wars, but then they did one of the indie figures as indie. One of the Han Solo figures as indies.
This is turning into like a whole pot of coffee conversation. It's great. It's nice to have a. It's still not shown up yet.
Not shown up. I'm gonna believe me. After this, I'm gonna call Consetta and read her the Riot Act.
I bet she sent it to James and Earl Taylor's house instead. So we apologize.
We do have fun though, don't we? We do.
Oh, absolutely. It's so refreshing to talk to fellow collectors, and of course, you're the ultimate collector. Then we've been the tuning the horn of Rancho Obi-Wan for a long time. Put all the press releases out for you guys, and Rancho Obi-Wan is an important place. It's an important place for collectors. It's an important place for culture. But why do you believe it's important for Rancho Obi-Wan to be preserved for future generations?
You know, I said it before, and I really do believe, and you'll find this in a lot of the books that I've written, that the merchandise part of Star Wars played such an important role to make Star Wars one of the most important and widespread cultural phenomenons of the last 50 years, even though we're not quite at 50 years. We're starting to get near that. And it was originally, it was a matter of happenstance. I mean, Kenner signed the contract for Star Wars a month before the movie opened because nobody was interested, because movie merchandising had never really been successful. And so Star Wars opened, it becomes this amazing phenomenon in the theater. People keep going back to see it, long lines. And where's the merchandise? And so, yeah, there were some posters, and you can go to a t-shirt shop and pick out transfers and have them, you know, pressed on to your shirts there. But it was the fact that the supply had to catch up with the demand rather than the way that things are done these days, where movie merchandise comes out, you know, a month to 2 months before the movie does. And the day the movie opens, it's on sale at Target. There was this real desire. And also, you know, those of us who were, you know, back then who saw Star Wars on the big screen, and saw the merchandise finally come out, it was a way to recreate the movie, because there were no VHS tapes, much less DVDs or streaming video. The only video was in the 1 minute cartridge you could wind yourself, and it would get scratchy about after the second time. And so if you wanted to go see Star Wars, you had to go to the theater, or maybe you could recreate scenes with your action figures and your vehicles, or create your totally new story with the same figures. Okay, well, let's have Han and Luke in a fight for the affections of what we didn't know was Luke's sister at the time. But you could do anything, and it's I think those play patterns and that longing that was finally met goes a long way to explaining some of that early connection with Star Wars that has continued. And it's continued because the story and the characters were so much fun, and the merchandise keeps coming out, and the expanded universe, which, by the way, is not dead in any stretch of the imagination. It's just been more clearly defined. It was never canon. It's still not canon. It's a legend, and they're still out there, and they're great, and nothing has really changed except saying we've expanded canon to include new books and maybe new video games and the new TV show, just like Clone Wars was. But the only canon that ever existed was stuff that George himself was personally involved with. So people were saying, I'm going to have to burn my library now. I'm sorry for the tangent, but I am so happy you said that.
We were going to ask you that at the end, so thank you for saying that.
Anyway, so this is history, and it's cultural history, it's sociological history, it tells you a little bit about why people decided to pursue creative careers. Yeah, a lot of people saw it and said, I want to go into special effects, or I want to be a writer, or I want to get in the movie business. But a lot of people said, I want to be an astronaut, or I want to be a poet. I want to get into communication. I mean, it was this liberation of creativity, and the merchandise played a big role in that. And I think it's really necessary, because not only is my collection large and on display, but it's really a story that I tell in walking people through it. It's a story of the international nature of Star Wars. It's a story of how the merchandise has changed over the years. I love pointing out a box of 3 1/4 inch floppy disks with a Star Wars screensaver, and having kids look at it and saying, a what? Well, wait a second, it's not even floppy, it's hard. And, you know, having to try to explain that. And as I told you with the little movie viewer, I mean, a couple of years from now, I'm not even going to be able to say VHS or DVD. I'm going to say, well, you know, there was no streaming video back then, because it just changes. And so seeing some of the objects that were made, you know, just 10 or 15 years ago that are now completely alien to kids growing up today, is great fun for me. And, you know, we have kids who are 4 and 5 come through here, some of whom are a little out of it, and some of whom are amazingly expert, so expert about Star Wars that they can stump me on trivia questions. And I get a little embarrassed, but at the same time, I'm sort of proud of that, too.
You should. Well, absolutely. And I'm sure I'm no math teacher. I am a high school literature teacher, and I've written a few blogs for StarWars.com. I think you've got me beat by quite a bit, I might add. But when I introduce the idea of tragic heroes, and I talk about Anakin Skywalker, of course, when we look at Luke Skywalker and the hero's journey of Joseph Campbell, one of the things I tell students that engages them the most is George Lucas's decision to waive his directing fees to take on the merchandising finances, and what a big deal that was, and what a shocking deal that was at the time, and how that has paid off for him.
Well, nobody thought it was a big deal at the time. I mean, I think,
right.
And George did get a directing fee. I mean, mm-hmm. was offered a triple amount, and he said, you know, I'd rather have the sequel rights, which nobody thought there would be a sequel, much less if the movie would ever get out there, and I want to have some control over the merchandise. He got more control after Star Wars, when they had to renegotiate for Empire. That's when he got complete control and the copyrights of the movies. But as much as anything, I mean, you know, I had an interview with George for my first book before I worked for Lucasfilm. And I said, well, you know, were you thinking about the merchandise? Because there was a clause in the contract which didn't speak about merchandise so much as it spoke about George would have the right to start up 3 Star Wars boutiques in New York, in Beverly Hills, in San Francisco. And I thought, what are you going to put in Star Wars boutiques? And he said, I really, when I was writing it, I only thought about 2 objects. And one, because I based Chewbacca on my dog, Indiana. It's funny he didn't use that name. No. dog breed mugs were really popular then as they are now. I thought about a Chewbacca mug. And so one of the first thing was this incredible three-dimensional Rumpf Chewbacca mug along with Obi-Wan and Vader. And then because Ralph McQuarrie came up with the shape of R2-D2 as a barrel, he was a natural cookie jar. And so that was another one of the early items. But he said, yeah, really, merchandise was not top of mind for me. The fact that he did that turned out to be an amazing blessing. And the Fox Board of Directors, if I may say, which was pretty stupid, I did a 10th anniversary interview with George for the Wall Street Journal as an op-edit page column, and I had some somewhat negative things to say about the Fox Board of Directors not understanding it and being reluctant. I mean, all of which I know is true. And one of the board members who is some top executive in some company, you know, wrote this letter to the journal that they published. Oh, that's not true at all. You know, yeah, bull quink. it was true. And in fact, because Alan Ladd had faith in George, he didn't know what to make of this first draft of this strange, the Star Wars script, but he had faith in George as a filmmaker and liked him. And green-lighted the movie and was, yeah, George, okay, if you want, yeah, okay. You sure you don't want the extra money? Okay, well, yeah, sure you can, yeah, have the... Well, they fired Alan Ladd Jr., who is one of the nicest and smartest executives ever in Hollywood because, oh, he gave away Star Wars. Well, they still continue to make millions and millions and millions of dollars on Star Wars. And they kept it for six movies. And Ladd went on to make a lot of other great movies as an independent. And he was too nice a guy to work there, you know, frankly. In the Hollywood system as it was back then, they spent their Star Wars money on buying... a ski resort, a Coca-Cola bottling company, and some other piece of crap. You know, and then eventually Fox got taken over and went private by a Denver oil man. And then and then Fox, Rupert Murdoch came in and bought it. And it's a very successful company now. But it has, like so many of the movie companies, a very, very strange history. And, you know, it's the kind of place, like any other, that you have a love-hate relationship with.
But now we've got that documentary out there on Alan Ladd as well.
Yeah, I'm so pleased. Yeah, I was a supporter of that, and it's blown past its goal. So I am really, really looking forward to that because he is and remains one of the nicest guys ever in Hollywood and one of the most talented. And he is the guy who was responsible after two other movie companies turned it down, but who made Star Wars possible and who fought for George and got him the extra money he needed twice. And, you know, he's a great guy. He's a truly great guy. So that documentary made by his daughter is going to be super.
We look forward to all that stuff. And like you said, I'm glad it's got funded and it's on its way to production and everything. And, you know, speaking as, you know, new things are coming on the horizon in 2014 and moving into episode 7, all these great things we're going to be seeing with Star Wars Weekends. And what's the biggest collectible or collectibles you're looking forward to in the future?
Yeah, the future. You know, we have a limited amount of space here. And I'm no longer working full time for Lucasfilm. And I'm doing things here and there. As I said, the word nonprofit really means nonprofit. So my ability to buy all the new stuff is limited by both those factors, both the income factor and the space factor. Although we have figured out a way to eventually squeeze a little more space into here. We've just opened our new 700-foot events room. And in the first month of that, we've actually had seven events here, sit-down lunches and dinners for 30 to 65 people plus tours. And that's working out really great. We want to expand that. But, I mean, I look at the new sideshow pieces and I go, oh, wow. But you know what? I have a really nice Boba Fett from Don Post. And whereas I'm not really crazy about the Han and Carbonite that I have that was done by Elusive Concepts, and this one sits up and has the real side panels, and I really want to get it, I'm not quite sure, you know, I can afford it. So, you know, there's going to be a lot of wants out there. And then I look at the new Vans canvas sneakers.
Oh, yeah.
They're very cool, but, you know, try to find them, you know, at not double or triple prices on eBay. I went through that with a lot of the Adidas shoes. You know, that's how you pronounce it. Adidas, not Adidas. I didn't know that, but
I didn't either.
It was founded by a guy named Adi Das in Germany.
You're kidding.
So the first time I heard someone in licensing say Adidas, I looked at her like, what? Oh, yeah. But if you say it now in the U.S., they look at you like you're crazy. So I pardon that little divergence there. But so, yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing what's coming out there. As I said, I love the new the big figures at the Disney stores. And then they have, we saw a bunch of us went down to Disney store headquarters a few weeks ago.
I saw that.
The mugs, the coffee mugs or milk mugs that they have are incredible because they're all different shape and different sizes depending on the character. And I've never seen mugs like this before. And they're very coolly decorated. I saw that and I said, you guys got it. This is, I mean, the figures are incredible. That's incredible. They have these wonderful notebooks, a Chewie. You open the cover and you hear Chewie's roar. Cleverly is not as loud as a Hallmark card because they know kids are going to be opening in school. But I take
yeah.
These things you have to think through. So yeah, there's a lot of very cool stuff. And of course, I know nothing about Episode 7, and I want to keep it that way as much as possible. And I'm sure there's going to be amazing stuff coming out from that. So it's going to be a real matter of picking and choosing for me, because I'm sure there's going to be an incredible amount of very cool merchandise out there for the far foreseeable future.
Well, those die casts that they revealed of the vehicles are just, and I know those were just not the final product, but they look incredible. I am very excited about those.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
I know. I feel your pain. And when you talked about the Han Solo and Carbonite, for the past year, since this is, again, our 1 year anniversary, we have been talking about when that comes out. And I literally had a fund to buy that. And then it finally was announced and I saw the price point and I thought, oh my gosh, my wife will freeze me in the freezer if I buy that thing.
I was a little abashed at the price point, but I understand, you know, the development time they put into it and, you know, and the care they took with it. And, sure. It's an amazing piece. And for people who can afford it, I'm sure they're just going to love it. And then, General Giant, one of my favorite lines is the 3 3/4 to 12 inch scale or higher of the action figures that they put on the giant.
Oh, I love those.
And I've sort of helped them a little with scanning some of the card backs and everything. And then I see the announcement for the 6 foot tall Darth. Thinking, oh my God, they'd be so wonderful in the museum, but do I have the room for them and afford them? And yeah, but they are amazing pieces too. So there's lots of cool pieces. And maybe if I don't buy all the other stuff, then, you know, just sort of scrimp and save for some of these bigger pieces, which are really amazing. You know, those three in particular, the Han and Carbonite and the General Giant Vader and Stormtrooper have really caught my attention. So I don't want to tell you what I once paid to try to get a complete set of Topps cards, including one of each artist card. And as I said, they broke me of being a completist. And that was a painful and costly lesson. But, sure. You know, you got to learn it sometime.
Well, so. It only makes sense to me that Sideshow would donate one to Rancho Obi-Wan and a coffee with Kenobi so we could do, our reviews. That just makes sense to me.
Except Enzo did donate a Darth Malgus to us.
I saw that, which was wonderful.
It's an amazing piece, and it's huge and overpowering, and it lets me talk to people who come through and explain the video game and what it's all about, how that's a whole world that people, you know, really love, and this is the evil genius who's the villain of the old Republic.
Well, that was good. that was really good. Ian McDiarmid.
Oh, thank you. I wonder if Dave Filoni's looking for any new voice actors.
There you go.
Well, I think he should just give you a call.
Yeah.
He's not busy these days at all. So we've got Rancho Obi-Wan and RanchoObiWan.org. Wait, and you've hinted around to a lot of these amazing things going on. But what new and exciting things are happening at the ranch? And how can we get folks involved and get a membership to Rancho Obi-Wan?
Well, the membership is the easiest thing of all. They can go to www.RanchoObiWan.org, and they can find all about memberships, which are $40 and include what we always used to look forward to from the Star Wars fan club, and that's a membership kit. And we do our things really nice because people are fellow fans, and they deserve some really nice stuff. So we have an annual patch, and if you've been a member the year before, you get an exclusive pin, and then our beginning of our costume cards of Obi-Wan, the first sketch of John Mollo for an Obi-Wan costume that we're going to continue for a couple of years as the costume gets closer to what we see in the movie. So we have fun with that, and we now have a weekly, or if I don't get to it, a bi-weekly blog that's often about collectibles. We've had some really great ones from our directors. Everybody wants to read about Star Wars barf bags.
I saw Gus's post on that.
And then Gus did a great piece about a 12-inch Luke Endor doll. Well, there was no such thing, but yes, there was, and it was used in pre-production, and he wrote about that.
The Jedi, yeah.
Pete Filmer just wrote one that we posted this week about a box of cards, a bizarre box of cards that I've had since 1989 or 1990 that I got directly from Gary Kurtz and never knew what the heck it was. And Pete figured it out because he had a certain magazine in his collection at home. And, you know, it's fun stuff like that. And Sue Rostoni, former editor of Lucas Books, who showed us for the first time ever a book cover that she was an editor on that actually had her and Ben Burtt on it that George vetoed, and why she was happy he did that. So fun stuff like that. And, you know, we're building that sense of community, and certainly we post a lot on our Rancho Obi-Wan Facebook page, but we're trying to get people more to the website. Then there are things we do. We have an Amazon affiliation, and now Amazon has a charity called Smile, and you can just sign in at the, once you go on Amazon and you click and you sign up, everything you buy on Amazon, we will get a small percentage of, and every penny helps when you're running an organization like this. You know, in the summertime, our utility bills in the ranch itself could be $700-$800 a month because of the air conditioning. There's security, there are professional services, and, you know, and eventually trying to put some money away to expand a little further, to protect and restore some items in the collection. None of the money goes to buying collectibles. That's all the geeks' problem, speaking of myself. So, it all goes to the essentials of running Rancho Obi-Wan. So we had and are now going to continue to have an annual eBay auction, and then on September 20th, and we've given lots of advance notice, and pretty soon we'll start to put up some details. September 20th is our annual fundraising gala. Last year, the theme was World Record Night. We'll be announcing the theme and some of the goodies and some amazing live auction items. So we hope to get a lot of people to that. We attracted a really good crowd last year, and we've had people from all over. We had our May the 4th party, and, you know, we did an online donate $10 to Rancho, and we'll randomly pick 10 people who can come here with another person. We had people flying in from Canada and Georgia. I mean, I expected it mostly to be local people, but it was great. And they got to spend 7 hours with us, you know, having a nice lunch and touring and watching Star Wars on the big screen. And it was a wonderful experience. And so, you know, we're going to be doing more events like that. As I said, we did march in the world famous Petaluma Butter and Egg Day Parade, and I got to ride in my Rebel Snowspeeder outfit, which was borrowed, but I think I'm going to get one made because it looks so cool. And maybe I can join the Rebel Legion, a member of the 501st. I just, you know, Star Wars keeps me young. It keeps me in touch with thousands of wonderful people around the world that I've met through conventions. I've been all over the world because of Star Wars. I could go to just about any city anywhere and know somebody because of Star Wars. And that is a truly amazing feeling. And it's that kinship and the friendship that is worth more than any collectible. And I really and truly mean that. That's what it's all about.
Oh, getting in touch with just that childlike passion and innocence and joy of Star Wars and all the amazing people that are Star Wars fans and Star Wars collectors. It really is a wonderful thing. It's a whole culture in itself that I think if more people were aware of it, we'd have even more fans as a part of the community, which seems hard to believe, but it truly is a blessing to be a Star Wars fan.
It is, and I think the community is going to expand as we, you know, get more movies out there. My best guess, and I have no idea how ticket sales are doing, my best guess is that Celebration Anaheim will be by far the largest that we've ever had because people are so excited about the new films and, you know, feel pretty good about the fact that, you know, they'll get to see or hear or meet, you know, at, you know, something to do with Episode 7 next April. Even though that'll be a while before the December screening of Star Wars, the premiere of Star Wars. So it's all good. And I know the folks at Lucasfilm and Disney have been working really hard on all aspects of Star Wars, the story, the merchandise, the fan activities. They are very much aware of how important fandom is to the continued success of Star Wars. And there is constant work going on behind the scenes with both companies and people that they've, you know, brought in. There's something fairly spectacular that's going to happen and be announced next week. I wish I could tell you, but now I'm just teasing.
You're just teasing us now.
So, I mean, there's all kinds of amazing stuff coming up. And that's because Star Wars fans are so amazing. And so, you know, without that, there wouldn't be any more Star Wars.
Well, and thank you for not only being such a big fan and waving the Star Wars flag of fandom, but for being a truly sincere, genuine, nice guy. And I think a lot of Star Wars fans are pretty discerning. So we appreciate that you have that passion and you're just welcoming people into the ranch and into your world. And it's really, really, it's as I've said, it's such a great time to be a Star Wars fan. And people like you help to make that experience even better. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dan. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. And now we've come to the portion of our program. We have our five questions that we ask each guest to kind of see some commonalities between Star Wars fans, very similar to the James Lipton Inside the Actor's Studio.
No, I'm fine with that.
Okay, very good. All right, Corey, take it away, my friend.
Sure. Okay, Steve, the first question is, what's your favorite Star Wars movie?
I've gone back and forth between Star Wars and Empire, but I think I have finally settled on Star Wars because without that movie, there wouldn't have been any others. And that's the one that transported me to that galaxy far away and made me feel Luke Skywalker's yearning because I had that yearning growing up and I escaped from a place that I needed to escape from. It was called Philadelphia, not a bad city.
So who is your favorite character?
Well, this is not called Rancho Jar Jar.
That might be the line of the night.
That's great. That's awesome.
It's a fact of one. And, you know, I've sort of lived my life in some ways following some of the qualities of Obi-Wan. I saw him you know, as the wise guide and the mentor. And in my professional career, as well as in my personal life, I've tried to be a mentor. When I was bureau chief at the Wall Street Journal in L.A., when I worked at Lucasfilm and brought in some really top people who are there today, Pablo Hidalgo and Mary Franklin, the role of mentor is something that I admire in other people and really try to hew to in my own life.
Well said. Your favorite line of dialogue or film moment?
Well, I've got a favorite moment, which is when Luke stands on the little hill looking up into the twin suns and that incredible John Williams binary sunset music plays. I mean, that grabbed me at the beginning of Star Wars, and that's when I said I really did feel Luke's yearning. My favorite line is different because that is a dialogue-less scene. My favorite line is, "Do or do not, there is no try." And I've tried... Whoops. I've pushed life that way.
Here's the question, the doozy question to ask you, which is just so incredibly ironic. But if you collect, Steve, what is your favorite collectible that you own?
Well, I don't collect. I have nothing in mind.
Thank you. Be sure to tip your waitress.
Yeah. All right.
I think my favorite item is something that to me is very personal for what I did for 15 years at Lucasfilm. And what Lucasfilm did in 1976, which really changed the nature of conventions and how movie companies, it took a while, but how movie companies reached out to fans. And that's in 1976, partly out of desperation and partly out of inspiration, a guy named Charlie Lippincott, who was head of publicity and merchandising and 10 other things, and was a comic book geek, went to about four or five conventions a year before the movie came out to introduce fans to Star Wars. And one of those was San Diego Comic-Con. It was only its sixth year of existence, and they went down there with Howie Chaykin and Roy Thomas, the artist and the writer of the Star Wars comics from Marvel, and showed a couple of slides. And there, and then the next one was after the movie was finished filming. WorldCon was in Kansas City in 76, and they went there and they had a room of props and costumes. And in both of those places, there was this canvas banner. And the centerpiece of the banner was a silk screened painting by Ralph McQuarrie that was the same as the decal that was on a lot of the film cans. And it was a portrait of the Starkiller. And it was the composite character that eventually became mostly Han, a little bit of Luke, a little bit of Obi-Wan. And I had been told that somebody at ILM had painted it for Charlie Lippincott to take down to Comic-Con and again to use it in Kansas City. And Ralph McQuarrie, the genius and wonderful man that he is, was here about 8 years ago. And he looked at the banner and he said, and this is about like 8 feet long and 2-3 feet high, looked at it and said, "I remember painting that." And I said, "Wait a second. You hand-painted that canvas banner?" "Oh, yeah, sure. I'd do anything they asked me to do. And besides, that's my original logo, and I still like it better than the one they came up with." That, to me, is a true piece of history that links me personally, not only with Ralph, but to Charlie and to the beginnings of fandom.
That is beautiful.
Yeah, that's a great story.
I'm moved by the Burger King glasses myself. I just find those. In fact, when I get the chance to tour the ranch, I'm looking forward to seeing those particularly.
Okay, we'll take you in the stacks. I'm not sure which glasses we have. You know, we can display.
I have them, but just some. They've been through the wash because we use them when we were kids. I didn't realize. Oh, Dan, you're going to want to keep these in pristine condition when you're older.
Well, I opened all my first 12 action figures, so
Exactly.
Okay, our last question here. What particular messages or themes about the Star Wars saga resonate or speak to you?
Well, you know, I think the whole good versus evil and the possibility of being saved, even someone who's gone so far down the road to just being a terrible, nasty, evil person. It sort of says to me that you should never really give up on anybody. And everybody has their own personal journey. And you really don't know what they have gone through or what they are going through. So, you know, sometimes you need to lighten up when your thought is to just sort of, God, I wish I had a lightsaber. It's acceptance, I think.
Excellent. Well, Steve, it has been such an honor and a pleasure. And something tells me that the van never showed up. So we'll just have to find an excuse to have you on again, and we'll make sure that van heads your way.
I'm going to send you a bill for a month's worth of Starbucks. How's that?
Okay, that'll work.
Well, Corey, I think it's safe to say we picked the perfect guest for our one-year anniversary to share a cup of coffee with us. Steve Sansweet, it's such an honor and a privilege to talk to you. And truly, when Corey and I started the show a little over a year ago, we made our dream list of guests. And number one, we had James Earl Taylor. And that happened. And you were number two. So thank you so much for helping to make these fans, like Corey and myself, just to be a part of Coffee with Kenobi and to celebrate Star Wars fandom with us.
Well, thank you. I have very much enjoyed being with you guys. Let's do it again sometime.
That would be wonderful.
I'd love that. And thanks for sharing your experiences and just your love for fandom and Star Wars in general. It was well said. You had some great points. And hope folks just be able to can relive all that and enjoy it as well.
Thanks, Corey. And thank you, Dan.
Absolutely. And of course, listeners, go to the link on our website to donate to Rancho Obi-Wan or go to RanchoObiWan.org. And there's a lot of amazing merchandise there once you become a member, and just great blogs and all kinds of information on Star Wars and fandom that you won't want to miss. So be sure to check it out in our show notes.
More to add, do you?
So what we're doing here is you always have our discussions on our show. It's an extremely important part of our show. But we're going to have two discussions here. Now we're going to talk. We're going to be a little self-indulgent. I hope you don't mind, everyone. We're just going to talk about our one-year anniversary because this show has meant a lot to us. It's been so cool for me to be able to have a voice as a fan. And Corey and I have always been friends, but this has helped us to be like brothers, really. And it's just been such an exciting experience. And we got some really fun emails and a lot of amazing MP3s and voicemails from friends and fans of our show and the listeners. And so our first email is, of course, from Melinda Wolf, and she writes, "Happy anniversary, Dan and Corey. I consider going back and reading all the feedback emails I have sent to you after each of your podcasts. I don't have time to explain why that would be a daunting task. I was going to pull out highlights from at least some of the emails to indicate how wonderful it has been to spend a few hours with the two of you since your debut last spring. How could I choose which were my favorite shows? It would be like trying to choose one child over another. Instead, please let me tell you this. I have enjoyed every single podcast thoroughly. I don't always listen to them on their airing days. In fact, I rarely do. When I learned that you posted a new installment, I carve out a portion of a day in the near future where I can sit down to give my full attention to each show. I do not want any interruptions once I hit the play button. You keep each show fresh, fun, and fantastic. I've loved your array of guests, both those who are well-known to Star Wars fandom as well as those who are a little less well-known. Everyone has something to share, and CWK has been an outstanding forum for everyone's voice. You keep each podcast upbeat, and it is evident you both enjoy what you are doing. I know how very busy the two of you are outside of Coffee with Kenobi, and your dedication to what you have created comes across the airways loud and clear. I'm not a very photogenic individual, but I wish you could see the smile that spreads across my face as I listen and hear the laughter that erupts when someone says something funny or agrees with my views on some Star Wars topic. Last fall, the two of you reached out to me to become a part of this Coffee with Kenobi family. It was a great privilege and honor to be the vanguard of bloggers who post their musings on the website. Being a part of this very special family means more to me than mere words can describe. As I've said before, and I will say again, the podcasts keep getting better and better. Not because there's been anything lacking in the earlier episodes, definitely not. As each Give the Evacuation Code soundbite announces another show's come to an end, I think to myself, there is no way to top the podcast I just heard. Then the next one airs, and I realize that that is exactly what happens. Thank you for brightening my days. Thank you for letting me be a part of your enclave. Above all, keep doing what you're doing. May the force be with you, Melinda. Well, that was so awesome, Melinda. Again, you've been such an important part of our show and our website and what you do, and we really appreciate your kind words and your sincerity. And Melinda's been a friend of mine for a long time, and Melinda's not someone who will sugarcoat things. She'll just tell you how she feels because she's intelligent and passionate, and I applaud that.
Absolutely. She's always sent us emails, and we feature her on the show, and she's, like you said, her passion comes right out of her words and what she says, and that's the reason we started to do the podcast anyway, just to be able to give fans a chance to be able to say what they want to say, and Melinda's definitely part of that, and we love having her. Our next email comes from Craig Dickinson, our future reviewer of Rebels, and he says, congratulations on 1 year of Coffee with Kenobi. It's been amazing to see this podcast blossom into a thriving network of like-minded fans, all dedicated to sharing their passion for Star Wars. For the first time, I heard about your podcast on Twitter, and you asked me to send in my thoughts on Jedi and attachments. I knew that this show, this community, would be unlike any I'd previously experienced. Your show provided a unique forum to discuss our favorite saga intelligently and deeply, while still giving the listener a legitimate voice and a myriad of opportunities to contribute. I'm honored to be part of the Coffee with Kenobi family, and look forward to seeing what the future holds. P.S. Rogue 3 standing by, Craig Dickinson. And Craig's always been another fan who's written in, expressed his opinions on some of the thoughts we've put out there, and he's definitely been a big supporter of us on Facebook, and we've become friends with most of these people that we interact with, just on a personal level as well. I find that fascinating. I never expected that aspect of it, but definitely Craig is up there with all of them and all of our friends and our Coffee with Kenobi family.
And Craig has been really nailing it on Full of Sith. He's appeared in the last couple of shows talking about his exciting curriculum with showing all the Star Wars films to his students. And it's just kind of – this is just one of the reasons, again, why we like this show so much, is people come on our show and it's not because of anything that Corey and I do other than we help to give a platform or a voice to all these incredibly intelligent people out there. Craig's on Full of Sith. He's been on Star Wars Kids Cast. Becca's on the Cantina Cast. She's on the Kids Cast. We just had Aaron on our show. We have people that I have a feeling are going to just start showing up on podcasts all over the place. And we're proud and humbled knowing that in some small part, we help to shine a light on these people who deserve to have their voice heard. This is, again, the reason why I like this show so much, because everybody deserves to have their voice heard in Star Wars and fandom in general. So it's so cool. It's just so great that we get to help make that happen. So now we get to share with you some of these amazing MP3s that have been sent in. And we reached out to a lot of our friends and just kind of put some stuff out there on Facebook and Twitter, hoping to get some comments on our 1 year anniversary. And the response truly has been overwhelming and amazing. There's fun, there's laughter, there's just so much sincerity. The Star Wars community is such an amazing community, and when you hear the MP3s that we are fortunate enough to be able to share with you, we're just so honored and humbled and thrilled, and people are contacting us all the time. I'd love to submit something, and it's such a blessing, really. Again, I can't help but gush, because it's kind of an emotional moment for me, Corey, because these people that are sending us in things, congratulating us, I'm huge fans of theirs, and it's sort of like surreal to me that they would take the time out of their schedules and their days to share their well wishes for our show. It's just so cool. It's just so humbling. It's amazing. There are really no words.
Absolutely, Dan. And like you said, it's a community, and they've really been welcoming us as far as we've been doing this show, and just people who've been kind of popping out of the woodwork just to be able to give us a helping hand on technical difficulties, or just a thumbs up here and there, or just, like I say, well wishes, and just they enjoy the show genuinely. And that's what it should be. I mean, I think it's emotional for us, but I think because it is exactly what we wanted it to be.
Hi, this is Ed Dollister from the IndyCast, and I just wanted to wish Dan Z, Corey Club, and all the team at Coffee with Kenobi a very happy first birthday. Hard to believe that it's been 1 year already. You guys are doing such a fantastic job with interesting, thought-provoking, and fun content that keeps getting better each episode. Here's to many happy returns, and if we don't get any news on Indy 5 soon, would you happen to be accepting resumes? Happy birthday, guys.
This is John Jackson Miller, author of Star Wars Kenobi. I was the first guest on Coffee with Kenobi a year ago, and I'm delighted to see that the podcast is now celebrating its one-year anniversary. I guess I didn't kill it. I'll be hopefully on again later on this fall to promote our new book, Star Wars A New Dawn, which comes out in September. Again, congratulations to Coffee with Kenobi, and may the calf be with you.
Hello there. This is Joa from the Cantina Cast, Dan and Corey. And on behalf of the Cantina Cast, I just wanted to say congratulations on making it 1 year with your podcast. Obviously, y'all find it just as enjoyable and just as fulfilling as Mike and I do. So many more years to come, hopefully, for your podcast, our podcast, and all the other aspiring podcasts out there. So again, congratulations on 1 year, and we will see you well before the second year, and hopefully get to congratulate you on that second year a year from now.
Hi, it's Rob here from the Bearded Trio. Just want to say congratulations to Corey and Dan for their first year anniversary for Coffee with Kenobi. A year ago, you hit the ground running, and it's just got stronger and stronger. You are my go-to for all things Star Wars, and especially keeping up to date on Star Wars 7. I feel very honored to be part of the team, and I can't wait to see what the next year will bring. Congratulations, and remember, the Force will be with you. Always.
This is Ian Desher, author of William Shakespeare's Star Wars, wishing Coffee with Kenobi a very happy one-year anniversary. The Force shall always be with ye, dear friends.
Hey guys, this is Austin Blankenship from Far, Far Away Radio. Wanted to send you guys a quick message saying happy anniversary. Our entire team loves your show, and we look forward to many, many more years of coffee, podcasting, and Star Wars to come. Thanks, guys.
Hi there, guys. It's Mark Newbold here from Jedi News and Radio 1138. Just wanted to wish you guys many happy turns. There's not a lot of top quality podcasts out there, but you guys are definitely amongst that small group. And it's all down to the hard work that you put in and the seriousness with which you take it. But we also have a lot of fun. I've been on your show twice and I've enjoyed both times thoroughly. And I'm looking forward to coming on again. So keep doing what you're doing because it's working. But all the very best and speak to you very soon.
This is Amy Ratcliffe, contributor to the official StarWars.com blog and Star Wars Insider, and I want to wish you happy birthday or anniversary, or how about both? I can't believe Coffee with Kenobi is a year old already. It's been wonderful to hear your take on the Star Wars universe, and here's to many more fantastic podcasts.
Hello, Coffee with Kenobi. It is me, the mic pilot, with
Ryan Young
and Bobby Roberts of Full of Sith.
Yes, and we want to give you the happiest of birthdays on your anniversary show. We're very proud of you. You put forth a great program. I enjoyed being on it. I enjoyed listening to it. And Coffee with Kenobi is on the tops of my Star Wars listening list besides Full of Sith.
You guys do a great show.
Hold on, Mike. You listened to we're on the top of our own listening list?
Yeah, I gotta edit the show.
Okay, all right. I just sort of imagine you like editing the show and then immediately putting it right back on again and just sort of staring at yourself in the mirror and going, yeah, this.
No, it's more, there's Bobby again.
Why won't he shut up? He's ruining the birthday message right now.
Again,
why
he's ruining everything.
Well, I think Coffee with Kenobi provides, you guys do a really great job providing a voice that I don't think exists elsewhere in Star Wars podcasts. I think you guys have a different take on things than we do or that other Star Wars podcasts have, and it's good to have you guys around.
Yeah, they have very good production values. They love the saga, and they put forth great ideas and theories and conversations of all things Star Wars.
Well, and I got them a birthday present, a one-year birthday present, but it's going to be a little bit late. I apologize, but you know, on the one hand, it'll be late. On the other hand, your one-year birthday present is me on your show. Come on. You can't argue with that. So, happy birthday to Coffee with Kenobi. And I'll be sipping some Java with you guys in June.
Keep up the good work, Dan and Corey.
You guys are great.
May the Force be with you, always.
Hello, Dan and Corey. It's Scott, Trisha, Jeff, and Gannon transmitting to you from the Fantastic Fortress. We know it's Coffee with Kenobi's one-year anniversary, so I'd like to congratulate you on that great achievement and wish you many more years of Force-brewed coffee talk.
Coffee with Kenobi. That title seems like it should mean something to me. Oh, that's Dan and Corey. Got it. Congrats, guys, on a year's worth of shows, and congrats on getting me in your stable of bloggers. But seriously, I love the show, and I can't wait for 12 more months of Coffee with Kenobi goodness, and I don't even like coffee. So keep up the good work, guys.
Hi, Dan and Corey. Congratulations on 1 year. It's been great having coffee and tea with you guys and discussing Star Wars, and I look forward to many more.
Happy anniversary to Coffee with Kenobi. Engaging celebration.
Happy first anniversary to Coffee with Kenobi. It is so hard to believe that it's been a year since the first episode was released. What a journey this has been. Seeing how this show has impacted the Star Wars community and how much this show has grown in these short 12 months is incredible. Not to mention how it has impacted my own personal fandom as well. Thanks to Coffee with Kenobi, my fandom is at a whole new level. Dan, Corey, I'm so grateful for this show and all the hard work you put into it each week. I'm so grateful for the hard work put in day after day by Lisa on the website and the social media sites. I'm consistently blown away by the incredible rotation of bloggers we have. Becca, Jay, James, Jeff, Troy, Joe, Melinda, Rob, each and every one of you blow my mind with your in-depth thoughts and just your pure love of Star Wars. It is a humbling honor to be a part of this journey with each and every one of you, and I can't thank you enough, Dan, and you, Corey, for taking me and everyone else along for the ride as well. Here's to Coffee with Kenobi in the many years to come. Remember, this is the podcast you've been looking for. And remember, may the Force be with you. Always.
Hey, everybody. This is Eric Blythe.
And this is Eric Geller.
And we're the hosts of the Forcecast, and we wanted to send a special shout out to Coffee with Kenobi.
Dan and Corey, congratulations on 1 year of your podcast. Keep up the great work.
Yeah, we know how hard it can be to meet the demands of podcasting and technical difficulties and scheduling and stuff like that. So being around a year and still going strong is definitely an accomplishment. So congratulations, guys. Here's looking toward another great year of Star Wars podcasting.
Congratulations again.
And may the Force be with you.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall. I play Hera Syndulla on Star Wars Rebels, and I just wanted to say congratulations on your one-year anniversary to Coffee with Kenobi. Special shout-out to Dan and Corey, and also thank you, Rob, Melinda, Becca, James, Jay, Jeff, and Joe. You guys are awesome. Oh, and guess what? This is the podcast you're looking for.
So now, Corey, just while we have a few minutes here, let's kind of talk about the show in general. Look at how far we've come, and what are some things that pop on top of your head with this?
It's funny because at the beginning we had some technical difficulties. We were trying to work things out.
Oh man,
I know we've been through a couple microphones. You have, I have.
Yeah,
just getting things fine tuned and just wading through the waters that is podcasting. And I know I've had to kind of find my voice a little bit as far as just being just a speaker. You've helped me with that. A couple other folks have written in and just given us well wishes and things like that, of just helping us get into Star Wars fandom a little further. And as I kind of review this year in my mind, I mean, obviously there's shows that pop up that I've always dreamed of, people interviewing people, but kind of in a whole, We've come so far. I feel like we've just kind of scratched the surface of what we originally wanted to do, and it's we're making kind of some of our goals that we wanted to in that first year, and I'd never expected that.
Yeah, I mean, I think we maybe talked about this when we first started, but our first show was about 22 minutes long, and I went over to your house about 5 or 6 in the afternoon. Yeah. I got home like at 3 or 4 in the morning.
Yeah, and that
for
was
22 minutes.
For 22 minute show, yeah.
If we did that now, we'd be dead.
And we shared a mic. Remember that? We had to share a microphone. So yeah,
it's... because my mic was picking up you, and your mic was picking up me, and we were looking at YouTube and Google and Yahoo and texting Mike Pilot and just doing all these kind of things to try to get this thing to work. And then we just thought, you know what? Let's just Skype each other. We only live about 5 minutes from each other, but it's worked out so much better. And and reflecting on the year, and it just, you know, your editing, one of the reasons our show sounds as good as it does is because Corey's become such a master editor, and we get compliments from other shows all the time about that, and that's all because of what Corey's done. So that I want to thank you again for that. And Corey, having these guests we've had, what are some of your favorite discussions and regarding these guests that we've had?
I know a big one for originally we had out was the Jedi and attachments. And that was kind of a big one we wanted to hit on originally just because it was a really cool topic. It was exciting.
And we had no guests for that.
We had no guests for that, yeah. And then we had Trisha Barron just after that, I think. And she had some great insights, and I'd never met her. I didn't know of her. And she was just like, she had been a long-time friend of ours. It was just refreshing to have her on and be able to speak to her about Star Wars fandom and the roles they play in the saga. That was a big one. I think a really big one for me to have on, like we said, was our list, was James Arne Taylor.
That was amazing. That, I was so nervous for that interview.
I know.
Because he was just, I mean, it was Obi-Wan Kenobi. He's going to be on Coffee with Kenobi. And he turned out to be not only such a great interviewer, but just a truly great, positive, spiritual guy. And all these people we're talking about, you talked about Trisha at all, and everybody, Mark and Ed and Joe and Mike and Amy Radcliffe and Mike and Brian from Full of Sith and Scott and Jeff from Assembly of Geeks, just Vanessa Marshall, Greg Weissman, all these people come on our show. And then for today's show, we had Steve Sansweet on, who couldn't have been more gracious and sincere. When we were sitting in that restaurant a little over a year ago, making our plans for the show and really just really being very specific and precise with what we want to do in our vision, I remember typing some of these names thinking, well, this is just like a pipe dream. This is never going to happen, but let's have high goals. And we've met a lot of the things we hope to achieve. And there's still so many things we want to do in podcasting and in fandom. And I just feel very blessed and fortunate that things are going to happen.
I'd like to also say, too, I mean, like we mentioned a lot of the guests we have had on and the people in the fandom and other podcasts, but I'll also like to mention that Lucasfilm and the folks working behind the scenes and we've contacted a lot of the publishing companies have really welcomed us and be able to send us materials to review and just getting that stuff just a little bit early and just being holding it in our hands and go, oh, this is really awesome that we could be part of this. And they respect us to be able to have, our thoughts and our opinions on it and just be able to enjoy that and interact with those folks. And it's grown fandom for us as well.
It's so incredible. And really one of the things that I've enjoyed the most about this show and I look forward to with the show is the friendships that we've accumulated and the people we've gotten to meet, all the listeners and our friends through Twitter and Facebook and people that we already kind of knew before, but now we've become like, they become like members of our Coffee with Kenobi family and are amazing bloggers and that just bring such interesting, fascinating content to the site that get people to talk and discuss about Star Wars in that critical way, that whole vision that we had for the show. And truly, and I think it can't be said enough, when we joined up with Rob Wainfur and the Bearded Trio, our numbers doubled like almost overnight. He's such an amazing guy and such a good friend of our show and just of us in general. And really, what would our website and social media be like without Lisa? Lisa's been so important to our show and such a good person and someone that I had the good fortune of being friends with before the show started, but she's made such a big difference too. We've been very fortunate to have such amazing people just working with us in the trenches to share coffee with Kenobi.
Absolutely. And I always think to future things, and I think this time next year, we've experienced, you know, a second year, and of course Celebration Anaheim will be come and gone by this time next year.
Good point.
And just like you said, Dan, this, making these friendships through fandom, I would hope to be able to meet every single person that we've interacted with at a celebration and just get to know them face to face, shake their hand and talk more Star Wars. And just, you know, it's, I think that's such a great community, and I just look forward to going to that convention and enjoying all those folks. And like I said, just getting to know them personally and face to face. And I think it'll be a great time.
I do too. That's going to be an amazing experience. It's just going to be so good to reach out to other people. I'm looking forward to that. Of course, I'm looking forward to more Star Wars news. And honestly, hey, this can't be said enough either, but I've just enjoyed our burgeoning friendship and just the camaraderie and the mutual respect and admiration we have for one another, knowing that when I send certain things to you for the show, they're going to come out great and through the editing process. It's just been such a pleasure and a joy of mine to get to know you better, Corey, and to work on this show with you. It's not work. That's not true. Sometimes it is work, but it's a labor of love. And this show wouldn't be Coffee with Kenobi without you. So I appreciate that so much.
Well, I appreciate that as well. And I will say you probably text me more than my wife does during the day, just with ideas and, oh, did you see this or that? Or what's your thoughts on this? And like you said, we've bonded more closely with one another as going through this process and just enjoying it through every thick and thin moment and just kind of radically expressing our love for fandom and going, oh my gosh, we got to talk to Steve Sansweet. Oh my gosh, you know. And like I said, you've always been empowered me to be a better person and as well as just a person to be able to speak my mind and be able to just enjoy myself doing this program and doing this show. And I never thought I'd be doing something like this. But it was your inception. You brought it to me. We kind of hashed it out. So you are the Captain Solo, and I'm the Chewbacca. So I feel that relationship has really grown really well.
That was very kind of you, sir. You're certainly tall enough to be a Wookiee, that's for sure. Yeah, I mean, there's so much work that goes into this and the different things we do to make each show come out and just the ideas that we have. And I encourage everyone who has a passion for Star Wars or anything to start a podcast, but make sure you have somebody you work with that you can be honest with and tell each other just your honest opinion on stuff. And you're not always going to agree, but you're not going to be disagreeable because you just respect that person. So it's been a pleasure, my friend. Looking forward to what the future brings on Coffee with Kenobi. Some of the highlights, or rather lowlights, over the past year of Coffee with Kenobi.
Yeah, not everything is, how do you call it?
Polished?
Yeah, not everything is polished around here with Coffee with Kenobi, but we enjoy some of the behind-the-scenes outtakes. Just take it with a grain of salt and enjoy. Our next story comes right out of the Indiana Jones locker. That makes no sense.
Our next story is more of a plug for our name.
Okay, I'm glad I'm the only one that's goofing up.
You're not. It couldn't have been any better if it was said by Elvis.
Oh, yeah, baby. Yeah, I'm like, let's see that.
For some reason, when you were talking last time, I just wanted to yell, you are part of the Rebel Alliance and a traitor. So many Benjamins in my wallet, you understand? Don't put that in there. Stop. I'm serious. Don't put that in there. Anyway. Holy crap.
Sorry, I tried again, dude. That was your worst ever.
That was the worst ever.
And I've had some bad ones, but you are usually spot on.
I'm not perfect. Don't let my hair and twinkle in my eyes fool you.
You filmmakers and you listen.
You've been doing so good, man. Every
I know.
Time.
Just slow it down.
There's nothing about milk.
Milk. You feel milk? Oh, film milkers. That's funny.
That's funny.
Okay.
How do you read to your kids?
I don't know.
Don't you have fun and make voices and stuff? You're awesome.
I always trip over myself.
You're a fun dad.
And today's show, kids, we're ecstatic about... Dude, that sounds too animated. Well,
yeah. I don't want you to be Krusty the Clown. I'm going to put that chopper thing in our collector's news.
Chopper. Oh, the toy. I almost mentioned that.
Yeah.
He's right, cool. Look, you don't like him? I think he's cool.
Well, I like him. I'm not ready to get a tattoo. I got to be honest. I got an email after I saw oh my God, I had a stroke. All right. Thanks to Rob of the Bearded Trio.
Outtake.
No such luck yet for us to interview George Lucas for Coffee with Kenobi, but man, what an awesome competition.
I think, too, it'd be any Star Wars fan's dream just to shake his hand and want to get on it, get in, and nothing I want to say.
Try on his flannel.
Sounds crazy.
And now let's join. I'm nine numb.
Roy.
Roy. Roy Hobbs is he's the natural. And actually, there are three. There are two trailers and now three character reveals.
Okay, let me start over.
Yeah, that was good. But okay. Do work on your math. And he's not a blar. He's our.
Work on your math. Talk says the English teacher.
Well, it's three versus
four two. Score, and I don't know how old I am.
That's history.
Your microphone was like two stories back. Your microphone was going, bzz, bzz, so, but it wasn't horrible.
Okay. Thanks for telling me. Well, after we recorded it, that was good.
Well, I was going to tell you that, but then I was going like this and I was like, he can't see me.
No. Do we need to do it again?
No. You were rambling on, so I don't even remember what you're talking about.
Joining us on this popular topic is none other. What in the world?
You had another stroke.
I know.
Stop that, okay? Just read it. Read it. Slow down. Just read it, dude. You got this.
Joining us on this. You're rocking me a little. Hey, man, I have helped you so much.
I know. Sorry. Go ahead. You're That's awesome. Right. You're awesome. Your mustache is awesome.
I must ask you a question, but I'll shave it for later.
Oh, nice.
I'm excited to see what J.J. Abrams and the screenwriters...
Screenwriters. Go ahead. Discussing Star Wars stories. Star Wars. Star Wars. Oh, boy. Disney is known for just... being
dollar bills, yo.
Okay, ready?
Try to start over or what?
Yeah, go ahead and start over.
Okay. For our first question. All right. And I read this probably 1,000 times today. Literally, I had my adding machine with me, an abacus. Take that whole thing, and that was ridiculous.
Sliding the beads over, aren't you?
Yeah.
Sliding the beads over.
So what we've decided to do at Coffee with Kenobi as far as Clone Wars, we're still not quite 100% sure on a title. Are you drinking beer?
I'm having a beverage, if you will.
Oh, man. On air drinking. Even Howard Stern wouldn't do that.
I know this isn't the Cantina cast, but you know I'm enjoying a beverage. I'm winding down, if you will, for the day. And
this has got to be – that's got to be in the outtakes.
Oh, yeah. I'll put that in.
That's hilarious. Our next email is from Melinda Wook. Melinda Wook.
Wookie.
You think about what?
I was gonna say, you know Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart, yeah. Other buddies? Yeah. Reminds me of us.
I'm going to mute my microphone and I'm going to take a big gulp of Coke before we do this.
All right.
Because, you know, I know I should be drinking water. I totally am aware of that. But, of course, I'm tired, so I didn't grab the water. I grabbed a can of Coke.
Sure.
Hang on. Can of Coke.
I can edit that out. Uh-oh.
You made me choke. Oh, damn you, sound bites. Okay, I'm ready when you are.
All right, let's do it.
Don't forget to send us your comments and opinions on the topic for show number 17, the Star Wars Heresies.
Heresies.
Hershey's?
Heresies.
We love seeing our Coffee with Kenobi.
you introduced Star Wars Reads.
He reads they.
We like a book. Who likes a good book?
I like a good book.
And the listener writes...
That's what they wrote?
Yeah. Hey, guys.
And now, let's join Rob Wainfur as he powers us. Powers us? Don't power you, cup, special shot. All right, sorry. Our topic for show number 20 is the... How do you say that?
Good.
Oh, my gosh. Why are you putting these big old 50-cent words in here? Why do we continue to help perpetuate...
Perpetuate.
Why do we continue to help perpetuate them. Okay. All right. Our topic for Shomer 20 is the methodology of rumors. How do you feel about rumors in Star Wars fandom? What compels people to generate them? Why do we continue to help perpetuate them? What, if anything, should be done about them? Joining us on this topic is Bobby Roberts of Full of Sith to help us break down this topic. In 500 words or less, be sure to send us your thoughts, comments, or an MP3 to feedback@coffeewithkenobi.com.
I like the sound of that.
Echo 3 to Echo 7. Hano, buddy, do you read me?
I saw part of the message.
I seem to have found it.
Our first email comes from Rebecca, and she writes, "Hi guys, I just finished listening to the last show regarding the expanding universe. I loved your commentary. It was very well balanced. I wanted to share a quick thought that came to my mind as I read the title Legends. First off, though, I'm definitely a fan of the EU, and I like where Del Rey and Disney are going. Now that the name Legends is a great choice because a legend always has some kernel of truth and actual reality. This bodes well for the future and the upcoming films, as the legend stories can be freely referenced in books and movies. This goes for story arcs, places, or characters, and gives the creative team tremendous freedom. So I'm very excited for what the future of Star Wars will be. I really hope there will be ebook bundles on iTunes, etc. for the various story series, like The New Jedi Order, Legacy, and Republic Commando. Do you have any contact to the publishing house to let them know this would be a great way to go? Hint, hint. Anyway, guys, great podcast. Love listening to your discussions. Keep up the great work. May the Force be with you all. Rebecca." And that email's from Rebecca Rao. And Rebecca, thank you so much for writing in. As far as contact to the publishing houses, not really per se so much as we would highly recommend Twitter. If you go to like Abrams and Star Wars Del Rey and everybody and just kind of ask, sometimes you'll get a response back. Twitter has been so instrumental in networking for our show. So I certainly think throw that out there and who knows who's going to respond. But I think that would be a natural fit. I would love to see those bundles.
Absolutely. And yeah, on iTunes or on Amazon, if they start bundling stuff, especially too with the Dark Horse series that's wrapping up. I know that all those series will be kind of gone and out there as far as Dark Horse putting those out. I would love to see those put out in bundles as well. I love reading all that stuff. And I need to get to a lot of this Legends series and get caught back up with a lot of the stuff because they're fascinating stories. I love it too. And like she said, it's love to go back in and dive into these characters. Our next email comes from Mike McDonald. He says, "Hello, Dan and Corey. I've been following you on your Twitter feed for quite some time now, but only recently discovered your blog. I just wanted to mention how much I've been enjoying the last few articles. I just finished reading Why Revenge of the Sith is So Good. Although I consider it my second favorite Star Wars film, next to Episode 4, I completely agree with the points made by Joe. Such a good story on so many levels. Mike McDonald." Thanks, Mike. I know that our bloggers work really hard to put content out there for us. And like I said, like all of our stuff, they put their passion into it. I know Joe's been really a big contributor to that, and he puts out some great stuff for us, as do all our bloggers. We've had a lot of our bloggers go on to do other things as well, kind of promoted in different realms and things like that, and we're more power to them. I think it's great to be able to get out there and get your voice heard. And
yeah, our bloggers, we mentioned this earlier, but our bloggers are so important to our show and our website and what we do. And we're just very blessed. We're biased, but we think we've got the best bloggers out there talking Star Wars because they're part of our family and it means so much to us. Our next email is from Melinda, and she writes, "Hello, Dan and Corey. Have you two missed me? I hope not too much. Show 18 was fantastic. What a great show to listen to now that I'm back in the swing of things. Lots of exciting news and your guests were superb. I thoroughly enjoy listening to everything you all had to share. Specifically, I would like to comment on the topic of the EU not being considered canon. This is a bit disappointing, especially since I remember Paulo Hidalgo indicating at C6, I think, they had been tasked with bringing some or much of the EU into canon. However, this will be a daunting task for anyone to tackle. What would you pick and choose? Because that is what it would amount to since there are so many inconsistencies in the EU. Why should this news cause such an uproar? If you'd like to hear my two cents on the subject, it shouldn't. Look, the long and short of it is that one should read for the simple reason that it is fun to read. Who really cares if everything or anything from the EU is brought into canon? Obviously, some fans do, but I think they take all these things way too seriously. This is a fictional world. Too many people forget that. Read for the pure enjoyment of getting lost in a story. The one Star Wars novel to which I'm looking forward to, Heir to the Jedi by Kevin Hearn. Don't laugh. Is this surprising? How can a Luke Skywalker fan not be looking forward to this novel? Do I care whether it's considered canon? No. I'm going to break the binding with the same intention I did with every Star Wars book, to be transported to that galaxy far, far away. The way The Empire Strikes Back ends, it was a fitting ending. People forget that George Lucas grew up a fan of the Saturday afternoon serials, and that most definitely had an effect on the way he chose to have The Empire Strikes Back end. Those who can't deal with a cliffhanger ending, they're missing out on a great cinematic literary vehicle. If nothing else, it gets you coming back for more. And Corey, you're not alone. I'm behind on Clone Wars too. Tom and I have watched only the first three episodes of the newest season. Maybe we too should have a marathon on Sunday the 4th. Melinda Wolf. Well, thanks, Melinda. Interesting what you said about canon. And we just had on this show, of course, obviously, Steve Sansweet himself said it was never canon, so he's certainly the authority. No one could possibly argue with that, I wouldn't think. I'm looking forward to Heir to the Jedi, and now that we know that it's canon, I'm pretty strict about that, and I know it's kind of silly. I've been talking about this since we started the show. It just means a little bit more to me because it's just something I feel like it's a little more solid and more grounded. What about you?
Yeah, I think she mentioned Pablo Hidalgo, and I think him indicating that, you know, they were going to try and fit the EU into the canon. I think that was definitely talked about in that story group.
Sure.
I mean,
and
I think
changed.
Absolutely.
I mean, they still say, you know, if it's good or not, if it's good, they said it's still an open field for us to kind of mine from it as it fits, as it works. So he's still consistent with what he said.
I agree. I think too, it's like you said, now we have some stability with canon and now the stuff moving forward coming out is canon, and I'm excited to see where it's going to go because this is brand new. So yeah, absolutely.
Chewie, get us out of here!
If you would like to respond to our question of the show, have a comment, or just want to say hello, send us an email or MP3 at feedback@coffeewithkenobi.com. Or if you have a specific question or comment for either of us individually, email us at danz@coffeewithkenobi.com or coreyc@coffeewithkenobi.com or visit us at coffeewithkenobi.com and click on the Contact Us section or comment on one of the stories featured on the site. If you enjoy the show, please write a review in iTunes. You can also like the show on Facebook at facebook.com/coffeewithkenobi, as well as keep up to date on our Twitter feed at twitter.com/coffeewithkenobi. You can also find us on Tumblr at coffeewithkenobi.tumblr.com. If you enjoy the jazz music, download the album Eye to Eye by Steve Torok on iTunes.
Give the evacuation code signal.
That's it for show number 19, our one-year anniversary of Coffee with Kenobi. A big thank you to Steve Sansweet for having a cup of coffee with us and discussing Rancho Obi-Wan. Be sure to go to our website, or ranchoobi1.org, to support this amazing place. Thanks to Aaron Harris for talking about Star Wars Weekends. Look forward to sharing his experiences.
Thanks to our media specialist, Lisa Dollard, as well as our bloggers, Melinda, Becca, Jay, Jeff, Troy, Aaron, Joe2, James, Craig, and Rob at the Bearded Trio for all their incredible contributions to our podcast and website. A huge thank you to everyone who contributed to this show and to all of you out there who listened to and emailed Coffee with Kenobi. Don't forget to send us your comments and opinions on the topic for show number 20, The Methodology of Rumors.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
This podcast is not endorsed by the Walt Disney Company or Lucasfilm LTD and is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only. The official Star Wars website can be found at starwars.com. Star Wars, all names and sounds and any other Star Wars related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Disney and their respective trademark and copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Coffee with Kenobi unless otherwise indicated.
There's no one here. Move along. Move along.